Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to Babcha Pearls. This is Chrissy McMahon, and this is the 15th of October, 2011, and we have the United for Global Change happening, and we have a very special guest. We have Sharon Elizabeth James, Reverend Sharon Elizabeth James from Sarasota, Florida, who has graciously agreed to come and speak to us on so many topics. I'm not going to take up another second trying to explain to you what you would like to talk about. So, welcome, Sharon Elizabeth. Thank you so much for being here today with me.
Thank you, Chrissy. It's an honor to be here.
Thank you. I'm honored to have you. And today we're going to start off talking about maybe October 15th, Global, United for Global Change.
Chrissy?
Or, yes, can you hear me?
Okay. Chrissy?
Yes, Sharon, I can hear you. Let me see if I can send you an email.
Hello?
Hello, Sharon. Okay, let me try to call her again. Seems I've lost the connection. Well, this is Chrissy McMahon. And
hello.
Hi, Sharon.
Hello.
Welcome.
Okay, we got disconnected.
That's okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, you're live on the air. How are you doing today?
I'm doing just fine. Thank you so much, Chrissy. I'm excited to be here. How are you?
I'm wonderful, and I'm so excited to find out today is the global call for unity across the world.
Yes, it is. How synchronistic is that, that we're having the interview on this particular day?
It's wonderful. I wonder who thought of that. It's interesting.
Well, I think it's just been a movement. You know, I got to tell you that, well, of course, you know, during the summer, there was, you know, the people, you know, in Egypt and in the Middle East, and of course, you know, coming to the streets and addressing corruption and greed and, you know, the old paradigm of the elitist and everybody else is, you know, just trying to make it from day to day. And I most certainly with cosmic energies coming in, particularly around the summer, you know, it kind of created a dynamic, I think, an awakening or quickening, you know, in the minds of people that clearly could see that things were not just or good or positive. And most certainly, I was impressed. I think I'd mentioned to you, you know, some time ago that around the end of September to October, I have something called the Anchoring Light Meditation. The story of that I'll go into a little bit later, but that started on July 16th of 2007. And I was very much impressed. I had a great awakening and quickening at that time, another level, I should say, and about doing Anchoring Light. And so, you know, 4 years later, every Monday, without fail, that has happened. And it's a channeled meditation, and went into that like, am I crazy? Is this real? But most certainly I can promise you that it is. But information had come I guess before the summer, just before the summer, around this time, specifically in the fall, towards the end of September and into October. And as you might know, some of your audience might know, this comet Ellen came on the scene. NASA picked it up, as well as others. You know, that this celestial body was coming into our solar system, and it's been a lot of chatter about that, again, all around synchronistically the same time. So when I got this very clear impression that those that participate in the anchoring light meditation, part of what they do is, you know, there's requests that come from higher celestial beings, you know, as well as our own higher selves, about holding space, holding light, holding energy for this time. I was impressed with the idea that something chaotic was going to happen, some sort of chaos. And so I was thinking in my mind, I don't know what it is, perhaps, you know, it was going to be, you know, more earth changes. But as I think back now and I'm looking at what's going on with, you know, Occupy Wall Street, I had a real strong feeling about that. I said, you know, this may be what it is about this movement or chaos or change that I was impressed with these very months ago, and I really do feel it is. So I have been really watching this basically from the inception. Of course, we didn't get it on mainstream media. You know, that's not going to happen. I think mainstream media came in on day 20 of the Occupy Wall Street. But I was aware of it. It's very early days. And one of the things, you know, I feel that it's a lot of our indigos, you know, that are participating. It's a generation of people who I feel have come here very consciously saying, you know, something's not right, and we can't just go along with the program. Pretty much like how in the 60s you had, and I'm coming from that generation, you know, where people, you know, said, wait a second, you know, we got to shake up some things. So what I see happening now is that this is really a global event, because you figure from the 1960s to presently, hasn't our world, our globe, our planet, you know, changed where we are truly a global community? So what's happening in one country is known around the rest of the world. Unlike in the 60s, you know, maybe you got the information days or weeks later, maybe you didn't even know about it. Now, particularly through the internet, through YouTube, through other technologies that is available to us now, we can clue in and know what's going on around the planet, you know, in a nanosecond. So I feel the impact of this is very, very profound. Occupy Wall Street, I see there people, the mainstream of the people that are there with the highest of intentions to say, you know, we are now going to be accountable to making sure that we have a planet that is equitable for all people, that comes from a place truly of the highest of intention of light, you know, and peace, and that we are aware that all of this is being manipulated by a few. It's been going on for millennium, and now the time has come for it to change, and we as a group of conscious individuals are going to start this. So I have been sending out on my emails, you know, to people to please hold light and prayer for this movement, because I think it's very important, or at least it's going to seed something that's going to bring about change later on. It has to. It has to. So I feel very positive. And let me tell you, I bought my little army boots about a year ago. You know, I said, I'm ready. So I don't know. I may have to hop on a plane, and I'm from New York originally, and get to New York and be there and say, we baby boomers are also, you know, part of this, and we want to see a change. So I think it's great.
Absolutely. And I'm sure there's people doing things in Florida. Maybe we're just not hearing about it.
It's all around. In fact, yeah, they have on this particular website, and you can, the audience can go there. Let me see here. If they Google it, they'll find it. But it has the locations around the world of where you can you know, where there are going to be different points of meeting. So, like,
yes.
For example, I got information about California, where they're going to be meeting, you know, in Britain. The website, I think, is, yeah, it is, it's called 15october.net. 15october.net.
Yes.
And it has there around the world where people will be meeting. Isn't that cool?
Yes, and I have the website, and I'm trying to post it on the Facebook chat site.
Yeah. Yeah, it says http://15october.net, and there's a little map there around the globe of where people are all meeting.
Absolutely. And I have the website open, so I have it's 951 cities in 82 countries.
Right.
That's pretty huge.
Right.
That's pretty big.
That's wonderful. That is absolutely wonderful.
Yeah. And there's a little video. It's not. It's just a little visual. It doesn't really give a lot of information, but pretty
well, you know, any. I feel like this, Chrissy, any movement is good, you know.
Yes.
You know, the thing I want to talk about, too, you know, is about timelines. I want to talk about prophecy. You know, I want to talk about a whole lot of different things that all converge, you know, with what's going on, particularly in this point in time in history. And there's also been, of course, you know, different epochs during history and during time. But most certainly I would say that we're at an epoch right now. And there has to be movement. I will tell you what kind of triggered it for me that this was going to be something to contend with. There's going to be a lot of the status quo that will say, oh, you know, I forget, I think there's been a comment about, oh, they just need to take a bath and go home or some kind of very irreverent response to that. And of course, you're going to have, you know, the whole spectrum of comments about this. But the guy that set himself on fire, remember there in the Middle East, in Tunisia, I think it was, but you know, when things get so bad, and this most certainly is not the first time that has happened in our history, people have done that. And it's a statement that says, you know what, things are that bad, okay, that I'm willing to make a statement by, you know, going up in flames. How much worse can it be? That's a huge, huge, huge statement. That should get your attention, that somebody is willing to do that. And in other times in history, that has happened also. People said, you know, this is so bad, okay, that death is nothing to me because of how, and I'm here to make a statement. And, you know, when I read about that, you know, I said, that sounds to me what I call a trigger. It's going to trigger something. And, of course, from that movement, from that one, you know, nameless guy, you know, not a leader. He was just there trying to make a living and had it difficult making a living because of the corrupt laws that were there. Okay, he couldn't make it for himself or his family. He tried. He did it the right way. Where it gets, the greed and corruption is so bad that you cannot even make it the right way. You've done everything. You've done the right stuff. Then this is when the revolution comes in. This is when, hey, something is really wrong here. And when that happened, I said to myself, wait and see what happens. And, of course, we know during the Middle East, you know, people got up and they said, you know, I'd rather die. I want freedom. I want the right thing. And it hasn't stopped yet. So occupying Wall Street and the different groups around the country, I think is finally the people realizing that, wait a minute, there's a whole bunch of us, you know. And not only that, we're not going along with the program, a lot of things that have been going on. I know nobody asked my permission if we should be exporting all jobs out of the country. Nobody said, you know, well, do you think that's a good idea or not? There's a lot of things that have been going on in the name of, you know, the people of the United States, and I'm sure with other countries too, where the population is like saying, I've never condoned that, you know. And then you're even to the point where,
that was back during the Reagan era when they did the free trade and the NAFTA,
Yes, right.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's from the
You know, and
that's
a lot of things have been done when we were sleeping, and you wake up and you're like, when did that happen? which is why people, I think part of the problem, Chrissy, is that we've handed our power over. We've handed our power over to say, hey, someone else takes care of us. I don't have to be engaged or involved. You know, it's all good. I'll be taken care of. I hand my power over to you. And, you know,
and part
people,
of it, too, is also because people haven't been given information. And when you don't have the true information, you don't have the full information, you can't make healthy choices. You've
no, you can't.
And given so much, yeah.
And that's
so,
the handing
I mean, not
over
in defense
like,
of us, but...
Yeah, but it's just saying, you know, and you're supposed to trust your government. You're supposed to trust, you know, those which we're programmed to say, you know, this hierarchy, whether it's a religious institution or a corporation or a government, you know, we have it. We'll take care of you. And at some point along the line, okay, at some point along the line, we just completely handed our power and said, okay, we're going to be busy doing this, that, and the other. And I feel that we have to be always in our power as human beings, as divine human beings, and be consciously responsible, you know. So I think that's
Absolutely.
What's happening now. We tried it the other way. Okay, we trust you. You take care of us. We're like, oops. Maybe we should be more engaged, you know, to see
Absolutely.
What's really going on.
Absolutely, I agree. And I think it's exciting, too, that that people in New York, you know, are inspiring people across the country to rise up in different cities to get involved in their own cities and protesting in their own. You know, I live in Pennsylvania, and Harrisburg just a couple days ago declared bankruptcy, but one of the officials denied the claim or something, so they want them to sell off national treasures. Like we have a lot of
Hello?
Different things. We have Gettys. Hello?
Hello?
Hello, Sharon. Well, anyway, Gettysburg. And
Hello?
There's just so many things in Pennsylvania that are national treasures that it's just amazing. But let me try to call Sharon back. I'm not clear why we keep getting dropped. I'm going to make sure she has the call-in number so she can call in, too.
Hello? Hello?
Hi, Sharon. Elizabeth.
Yes. Okay. We got cut off again.
I'm not sure. Do you have a call-in number in case we get disconnected? I mean, you're welcome to call in, too. Maybe if you call in, it might be a better connection.
Okay. I can do that. Let me...
Okay.
Let me find your email.
But what I was saying is that Pennsylvania is going into bankruptcy, and they're fighting that because they'd rather sell off, like in Greece, they'd rather sell off some national treasures. So, you know,
yes,
they want to sell off lands and all that. Mm-hmm.
You know, Chrissy, when you really see what's going on, I mean, you take the time out. What happens is that the way things have been set up, you know, it's like the thumb is constantly under us. We have to make a living, you know, we have to, and then we fall into the illusion of, you know, what is the American dream? You know, you need to have the house, the car, the this, the that, you know, and get caught up into an artificial, it's really very artificial, you know, lifestyle of this is supposed to make you happy. And again,
Absolutely.
People hand over their power to something else that says, oh, this defines who I am, and this is the measure of success, and this is going to equal my happiness. And it's all manipulation. It's all manipulation. And then you find people that get caught up in that, and they get everything, they do everything, and they still feel empty inside. You know, and then you have those that don't have the opportunity to do that, and they're really suffering. You know, everybody's under stress. So whether you come from the spectrum of, you know, extreme poverty or extreme wealth and all in between, you're just finding the masses of people feeling very stressed, feeling like, you know, is this what life is all about? And it gets you to a point to start to think, And we've always had thinkers. We've always had, and we've had warnings from these thinkers. They said, hey, be careful of this. This is what's going on, you know. And I think now people, this generation and groups of people beginning to say again, all right, enough is enough, and we have to address it. So, yeah, I feel this is a global thing that Occupy Wall Street is a precursor because of what happened in Greece. Look at them. Do you know the Pantheon? Do you know their treasures is owned by corporations?
I know.
Yeah, and if you thank God, we can go to alternative sources for information because you don't see this on mainstream TV.
I know, but think about it too. All this is orchestrated. This global oppression, financial oppression,
yes,
across the globe.
Oh, the New World Order is real. It is absolutely real. The Illuminati and, you know, agendas that don't service the highest and best for all humans, that is real. Okay, and with timelines, okay, we can either have a timeline where we go down the path that says, okay, you know, we're going to hand our power over and this is going to be the outcome, okay? We're going to move forward no matter what, but as humans, we have a choice. That's our divine right. And we can say we're either going to go through this path and say no, you know, it's, we're going to bring light to the planet. We're going to bring a planet for peace. We have this epoch in time and cycle of time to make this happen. And we are going to become responsible for our choices and not just think about it, but put it into action. That's one timeline. The other timeline is, oh, well, you know, I can't be bothered. Let other people do it. That's been the problem. Let other people do it, who are then going to define your lives. And you may have the people in charge that really is not interested in your best outcome. And if you do nothing and you don't become engaged and you hand your power over, well, you're going to have the outcome of that particular timeline. But no matter what, we're in a very important time. We're going to move forward. And I always say we can go through door number one, door number two, or door number three. Nothing in prophecy is set in stone because it has to do with your conscious creation, nanosecond to nanosecond. There is things that, you know, that are, have been a cycles and have been consciousness that's been so ingrained, and it looks like it moves in that direction. No matter what, there's evolution. No matter what, there's change. The only consistent thing about life is change. But how that change comes about to move forward into new tiers of evolution, to new epochs and times and cycles of time, depends on our conscious choices as individuals and as a collective. And as a collective. And that's where we are right now. Which door are we going to go through? Are we going to go through a door where we all become awakened and say, you know what? I got to be responsible and ethical and in my integrity, and I cannot sit back and allow this to happen. I must do something, okay? That's right. That's going to help all people. The other end of that is saying, you know, I'm in fear, and, you know, I'm going to take care of me and mine, and, you know, the heck with everybody else, and there's that side, and then you're going to have the consequence of those choices. And maybe even somewhere in the middle, it's okay. That would be less bumpy than the most extreme of like, okay, whatever's going to happen is going to happen. I stay in fear. So I'm hoping, I am affirming that there are people waking up, we're holding light, you know, we're holding prayer, where the way to do this is you must be in your integrity. You have to be in your authenticity. And above all, you must transcend fear. You must. And the way, the other thing with the bumpy road and, you know, the great, you know, shakeup of the earth and the polar shifts and, you know, whatever may or may not happen, okay, that is that's the way you kind of trip up to fall into fear. And that's how the manipulation happens. That's how you have to transcend fear. I would say out of everything else that we can do as a humanity, as divine beings, is that the key to all of this is transcending fear. Transcending fear. Because that way you cannot be manipulated anymore.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I completely agree. And that was one of the topics we were definitely going to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
So, why don't we start with your introduction of yourself and how your life brought you to this point? Because I think that's a fascinating journey, and I know bits and pieces of it, but I'd like to know the whole story. Maybe we could start there.
Okay.
I think that'd be great.
Okay. Well, let's see. Well, you know, I guess I have a very conscious memory. Now, I may not remember what I did yesterday, but I do have a conscious memory of when I was a year and a half years old. And I most certainly remember being like in the crib, and I remember my parents had a party and people were coming in and out to check in on me. But I think the thing I remember most of all is that in my crib I had this pointed-headed doll, you know, that was as big as me. It was made out of, you know, like a soft material. So that's a very clear conscious memory I have. And when I asked my mom about how old I was, she said I was a year and a half years old. So, and I think back then, as I think back at a year and a half, I already knew I was in a strange and alien place. But anyway, when I was 2.5 years old, I had, I guess what some people would call, you know, cosmic consciousness. I was just in my parents' apartment. And when I was 2.5, and I was just standing by a wall. And all of a sudden, I experienced this sense of omnipotent, omnipresence, one with everything. I was so much expanded beyond my little 2.5-year-old body. I tapped into a consciousness of just boundlessness and limitless. And in that moment, I knew that I was not in this physical life, like for the first time. I just had this knowing that I've been here before, and I had another knowing that I'm back here for a reason. There's a purpose and there's a mission. And, you know, that was it. It was just, it happened. And it was such a profound experience, of course. Well, you know, 2.5 years old, I didn't sit down and discuss it with my parents. I just had the experience. I really never talked about it, you know, until many, many, many years later. But I feel, looking back, that that was a very definite imprint in my mind. There was an imprint somehow that I would not forget that. Because, like everybody else, we then go into the world of conditioning. I was brought up by very strict, you know, parents. And then after that, you know, I went to Catholic school. I went to Catholic school from kindergarten. And then, you know, of course, there's the whole, you know, conditioning process. And I think that a lot of things happened to me when I was in elementary school. Because one of the things, a couple of things came up, but I remember being very, very young. I had to be maybe in the second grade, no more than the third grade, but I think it was the second grade. So I don't know, you're like, what, 7, 8 years old at the time? And the nuns, we were taught by nuns, and they had this beautiful picture, you know, of God, and you saw this guy with a white beard, and, you know, he was up in heaven with lots of fluffy clouds, and you had the angels, the seraphim and cherubim, and, you know, beautiful. And basically the message was that, you know, God is full of love, just love, 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 and, you know, which was great. And then in the same breath, the nun flips the, you know, the paper over, this thing that she's showing us, these pictures, and then you see, like, the devil, you know, and then the devil doesn't look too good at all, you know. It's like a kind of ugly-looking person. There's fire, and there's people not looking too happy. And basically back then in the catechism, which is what the Catholics used in their parochial setting for, you know, their schools, was that, you know, if you committed a mortal sin, and a mortal sin back there could, back then, was like if you missed Mass, okay, that would be a mortal sin. And so basically the message was that, you know, if you sinned and, uh-oh, you did a mortal sin, okay, and say you got knocked over, you know, by a bus and you didn't get what they call the last act of contrition, which was a priest that would come and anoint you and, you know, you forgive your sins, then, you know, you would go to hell. And, you know, the part that really got me, and I'm sure everybody else, that you would go there forever, like forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. So, you know, in my mind, and that's why I always look at little children to hear their opinion, because I think they kind of got it, you know, they're still kind of attached to this multidimensional, you know, awareness, you know, whereas you get older, you kind of lose that connection and have to kind of reconnect again. But in my mind, at first, I thought they were kidding. I said, oh, you know, you're joking, right? It's not forever. But then when I realized that, you know, the message was, yeah, you know, you don't do this, fear, then you will go to hell forever. So, you know, the nun had said, is there any questions? And so I raised up my hand. You know, I was always taught to be polite. And I asked an absolutely innocent question because I couldn't figure this out. So my question basically was, how can a God of love, you know, the one you just talked about, love, you know, create a place where one of the creations, you know, which I already knew I was going to mess up. I knew I wasn't perfect. You know, how can they just be, you know, go to hell forever? And that's the end of it, suffering forever and ever and ever. And I guess, you know, Chrissy, it was maybe a profound question. And I believe maybe the teacher, you know, she didn't know how to answer that. And so her response was to me in front of the entire class, well, that was a stupid question. And if anybody can't ask an intelligent question, don't ask any questions at all. Well, of course, you know, that was just a mechanism to, like, you know, let's not go there. And but I will tell you, one or two things could happen, and I think that was a very defining point in my life. Because either I could have been crushed and never asked a question like that again, or in my case, under my breath, I said to myself, that's not a stupid question. And I think that was the point of me becoming an independent thinker, you know, me being an iconoclast. I think I was 7 or 8 years old. And, of course, but, you know, I look back, I used to look back at those pictures, and, you know, there are some very good things about my experience, because one of the things that they did, you know, they talked about, of course, you know, Jesus the Christ and the Blessed Mother, and the Blessed Mother concept was, you know, really about the divine feminine. And back again in elementary school, I said something is not quite right with that. You know, I went to a beautiful, the parochial school was attached to a beautiful, beautiful cathedral type church in Brooklyn, New York. It was called Our Lady of Lourdes. It's since burnt down, but in its day, it was based on the cathedral in Lourdes, France. And it was always very inspiring, you know, to go there, because it's not so much even the hierarchy of who or what is being said. It's the true intention of those people who come there, you know, with love, with light. So I never worry so much about who's in charge and who's saying what. Any holy place is about the intention of where people gather together. And the people have really come in true earnesty, you know, of wherever they are. So it was an environment that was always inspiring to me. But early on, too, I had a couple of real issues that I was very concerned about. One is that I just saw this imbalance between male and female. It was just very clear and very evident. You know, women couldn't become priests. You know, you had to go to a confession, and, you know, and you couldn't go to God direct. You had to go through this guy, you know, who was a priest. And, you know, I just said that doesn't make sense to me. And reason the reason why I'm a ordained minister, by the way, is because I couldn't be a priest. I knew early on, I said, I think I'm supposed to do something like that. I guess I can't do it through the Catholic, so I have to find another alternative. So that was one of the key, you know, things, is the imbalance. And I felt very strong. I had a strong attachment to the Blessed Mother and to the whole feminine thing. And this, again, is all, again, very, you know, early in life. This is all elementary school. And then the other thing, I was in the fourth grade, and we were doing a lecture study on India. And one of the things in it, they talked about, you know, the cow, and that in the Hindu religion, you know, the cow, and the, particularly a white cow, was, you know, very important. And the concept of reincarnation, I was exposed to the very first time. And, of course, I guessed in my mind that imprint of what happened to me, you know, 2.5 years ago, although I didn't consciously put that together, but I know now that imprint was just so strong. So when I heard the concept of reincarnation for the first time, I was like, oh, wow, you know, that makes sense. But then I remember clearly, and it was a lay teacher. She was not a nun. She was a lay teacher, and she said, well, of course, the whole concept of reincarnation is not true, because don't forget, I'm inside a Catholic school setting, and they don't believe in reincarnation. And so I was like, I was shocked. I was like, well, how many people are in India? And I forgot how many, you know, million people are in India. I said, well, shouldn't somebody tell them, you know, that they're, because they believe it. So, you know, none of this stuff was making sense to me, none of it. So finally now, you know, into high school, and I think at high school, one of the things I had the ability to see through stuff, I could see the hypocrisy and what was happening. I could see, well, do as I say, but not as I do. And then the other part that really got to me, and this is why I started to become more rebellious now in high school, although always very, you know, respectful, because that's how I was, you know, brought up. But, you know, even I saw the dynamic, you know, between the races, you know. It was during the time of the 60s and, you know, the time of Martin Luther King and, you know, the time of, you know, the Vietnam War. And more and more I was beginning to say that, you know, this place is really messed up. And to be quite frank with you, Chrissy, when I was about 9 years old, I was either 9 or 10 years old, when I really got to begin to see what this world was about, I was very upset with God. I was very, very, very upset yeah. with God, because I said, I do not belong here. There is a big mistake. I shouldn't be here. I thought at that age, this was the most heinous, the most, you know, reprehensible, you know, archaic planet. And when I was in school, I always referred to this, you know, other kids would say, well, the world. I would always say this planet, like with an attitude, this planet, you know. So many of us, I'm sure, can relate, you know, looking up at the stars at night and saying, hey, you know, I'm missing something here. You know, there's a longing when you look up at the stars, like, you know, why am I here? Am I supposed to be here? There's a big mistake. I feel that somehow these stars up there, you know, there's a bigger picture that's going on. And many, many of us have that experience. Many of us that are on the show, you know, would have one way or the other, that kind of experience. So, you know, I had to get over the fact that I was stuck here on planet Earth. And, you know, suck it up and make the best of it. And, of course, you get caught into the 3D world. And I can tell you now, one of the most profound things that has happened to me, well, I would say fairly recently, which I think I tell you, Chrissy, is that my cosmic memory came back. You know, it's taken a long time. But my cosmic memory, at least parts of my cosmic memory, has come back. And so one of the things that I was shown was, you know, there was always this statement that says, you know, this is the world of illusion. Now, you know, growing up and being in this world, the world of illusion, I never got that concept. You know, I said, hey, if I take fire and I put it to my hand, okay, that's real pain. There's nothing illusionary about that. But what I had been shown is the what they call the world of Maya. It's a construct, and it is the analogy, just like how during the oil spill, and this is when this information came to me, during the oil spill, how things are yucky and mucky and you can't see. If you're in like inside oil, like say an oil spill, you can't see 3 feet in front of you. It's just dark. It's just you're in the muck. And the illusion is that this reality bite is so limited into a certain construct that you can't see outside of the construct. You just can't. And so it's very real for you unless somehow you evolve beyond the world of illusion, or what they call Maya, the world of Maya. You get above it, or you're in a different frequency band to where you can see it, and then you realize like, oh my God, there's so much more. There is so much more. And yeah, I was stuck in this little box, you know, this little constraints of a 3D, but it's just part of a much larger, larger picture. And so that's where the world of illusion comes in. So most certainly, all of us very easily, very quickly get into the world of illusion. You know, I too, you know, high school, want to go to college, want to get married, get a good job, make money, have a house, a car, that, the same thing, you know, just like along with everybody else. But there's certain times, you know, we have to think about how can we dream. And of course, there's the fact that we dream. You know, the fact that people dream at night, that means there's some stuff that's going on that is beyond our conscious awareness. You know, there's so many clues. There's so many clues, okay, that I'm not talking anybody has to be psychic. I'm just talking just in general, that there's a lot more that's going on. And, of course, now, you know, where we are right now, I'm very much into ancient wisdom. You know, I've gone to Bolivia. I've gone to Peru, and the quest there, the spiritual quest to receive information from these areas, because information is stored in bone and stone, bone and stone. So when you get around these areas energetically, you know, like crystals, information can be transferred. And we have to understand this too. You know, we figure in the world of illusion, the only way of communication is, you know, are limited to our physical senses. You know, somebody has to talk physically, move their lips, voice comes out of a voice box, you have ears, you have to listen, you know, as those sound waves from somebody's mouth comes into your eardrum and your brain interprets that, you know, or you touch or you taste. And that, again, is in the world of Maya, into the world of illusion, because there's so many other dynamics of communication, including telepathy. And one of the things early on, too, that we learned in some class, a science class or psychology, I don't remember which one it was, is that the human brain, you know, we only use like a very small portion of it, you know, so what's with the rest of the brain? You know, why is it there? And, you know, we only use a very small thing. So I think in everybody's life, you know, whether they consciously choose to address it, and there are many who consciously choose not to address it, there are clues along the way. Now, I could tell you that when I got to college, there was a club. And I guess you could call it the occult club, you know. Now, to me, I was always interested in parapsychology. And I guess the reason why is, one, I've experienced it all my life from little. So I guess, you know, my questions about, you know, school and, you know, the spiritual or religious components of it, I was always inquiring. I remember very clearly my first conscious memory outside of the, you know, cosmic consciousness at 2.5 years old. I had a a sore throat, you know, the kind of thing that goes up the air, the eustachian tube of the air. And that is really like one of the things I just dreaded. You know, that was just an awful, uncomfortable feeling. So I was very little. I don't know. Maybe I'm like 6 years old or something. And I feel this, you know, I'm in pain. And so this very loving, you know, woman comes over and, you know, she's like soothing me and she's touching me and I'm going to feel better, don't worry, and so forth. Well, I thought it was my mother, and I spoke about it the next day, and my mother has said, no, that was not her, it had to be a dream. And I'm like, well, wow, that was so real, you know. And so that was one of many other experiences I was having, and I said, you know, I think this is very, very real. But again, what happens, you know, when you're younger, I always tell people, what were you thinking about? What was your feeling or sensing when you were little? Because that's going to be like one of the key clues, you know. What did you sense there was something else before you got totally immersed in the world of Gaia, into the world of Maya, you know, into the world of illusion? So everybody who's listening, if you can, just kind of think back as to when you were very, very little, as far back as your memory can. And you can intend to say, well, I don't remember. Well, you can intend and really take the time to go back. You can trigger those neurons and pathways within your brain to take you back to that moment and just kind of sense what you were feeling or what you were knowing back then. Because that's a clue. That's a very, very important clue on your transcendentalness, of your ability that's beyond the illusion, you know, of this 3D reality world. But after college, I was involved in this little thing called the occult club. Now, this is what you need to know. I actually come from a family of psychics and mediums, of which I did not know. And the reason why I did not know, because my parents did everything in their power to keep that knowledge away from me, because they were not having that at all. I don't know how they perceived I would be, but I had a very famous aunt, and she traveled around the world, and she was a very, very renowned psychic. And my grandmother on my father's side was a medium. I did not know any of this, not until I was much, much older. And I guess my parents in their own way, because they didn't understand what I was going through or didn't think it was good, whatever their perception was, they thought it was important to shield me from this information. However, when I was in college, I kind of reconnected with my aunt. I got to know more about my grandmother, who I met only one time in my life when I was 7 years old. And it was my aunt then who had cards. And she didn't even have tarot cards. She had regular playing cards. But I remember she did a reading for me, and she showed me a little bit about the cards. So in college, just for fun, during the, you know, lunchtime cafeteria, I started to take these cards out and started doing readings. And this was generally for fun. And let me say this to everybody, okay? When you start doing those kind of things, okay, when, you know, it triggers, things begin to happen. Your brain, now we know more about the brain, and, you know, it begins to, like a muscle, it begins to say, hey, you know, we're going to look outside the 3D world into another transcendental, you know, frequency band, if you will. And next thing I know, I have people coming back and say, oh, you know, you said blah, 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 this, that, and the other. Well, nobody was more shocked than me. I was like, really? And then finally, it started to, this whole thing that I just did in jest and fun, it started to become serious, where people were like, you know, I was getting a reputation that I could do readings, and I'm like, wait a minute, no, that's not me, I was just kidding around. But that's whatever I triggered, you know, astral projection and leaving the body and all of this kind of stuff started to happen. And what happened, I got scared. And that is why you want to, you know, do these things, and you do these things in a very positive and guided way. And so at that point in time, I was dating this guy, and he was the type of individual, like my parents, you know, you sometimes we marry our mother or our father in another person. And that's what I did. So out of
sometimes
the frying pan and into the fire. So,
yes.
And this was very, but all our lessons are very profound, because this was another point in my life that I think was very self-defining. And this time, what happened was, you know, this guy popped up. He wanted to get married. He pops up with a ring. I do the little astral projection thing, and I get nervous and scared about it. And he's like, "Oh, just leave that alone." And hey, let's just get married. And hey, let's. And you know what? I really didn't want to marry this guy. I just didn't want. I knew it. I knew. I said, "No, this is, you know," but I did not have the courage to be my authenticity. I didn't have the courage. I was so involved in the world of Maya, into the illusion, that I felt compelled that I had to follow the instructions of what a young lady in my particular culture was to do. And that was, you got up to a certain age, and then you got married, and then you had a family, and, you know, that's it. And I was just really, I was, again, in a very strict family environment. I was strict in a Catholic school environment. It's like, I am anything, I'm expansive, but always it's been almost like a karmic thing that, you know, keep my power down. And I realized, this is very interesting, that when I came in, and we all have to be, who is listening in this audience, if you come in with power, you have to own your power. And I was in a culture where, oh, you know, you can't be too powerful, that's not good, or, you know, I always felt I had to kind of, you know, draw in my real true power. I felt that I could not be in my true authenticity as to who it was. And I paid a price for that. Because what I did is I allowed myself, I chose to go along with a program of getting married and going down this path that I knew deep down inside was not the right thing for me. But it is so strong, the world of Maya, the illusion, the constructs, the conditioning, is that I put my authenticity on the side and went along with the program. Well, of course, you're going to pay the price for that. And it wasn't too soon afterwards. You know, I did everything I was supposed to do. You know, I was a good girl, you know, did what I was supposed to do and went along with everybody else's program. But one of the issues, obviously, I had is that, you know, to love other people, you have to love yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently that was not a priority in my consciousness at the time. And I went along with the program, and going along with that program, quickly I found out this. I found out it doesn't matter who understands you, Chrissy, okay? What's important is that you know what's going on in your own mind. It doesn't matter if anybody else understands it or not. You must be in your authenticity. You. And I went through a situation where I came to the point 4 years later, like the person who, you know, put themselves on fire, I'd rather be dead than to continue this lie, to continue this thing. And it was quite dramatic and how it all happened, but I finally got out of that situation. And at that point in time, when I said I'd rather be dead, and I said I've done it the way of the illusion, you know, the way society, cultural, you know, family, religion, society says do it this way, said I did it your way, that's what happened, now I'm going to do it my way. And that was really my liberation. And I want to tell everybody that's on here, you know, the thing that brings you to your knees, the things that you say, oh my God, how am I going to make it? I don't know how I'm going to get to the next day. The thing that brings you down to your worst fears is a blessing. It's almost as if you
absolutely
have crumbled to rise up like the phoenix, to finally start your path to freedom.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And so after that, you know, the universe will just come and support you. I guess I want to tell people this is like what's so important to know. It's like when you find the courage to transcend your fear and say, it's like the tarot card of the fool. You know, the tarot card of the fool, you know, you see a person, they're holding like a little satchel, and they're on the mountain, and they're getting ready to step off into the abyss. There's nothing there. And what that tarot card symbolizes is that all the tools that you need, you have. It's in that little satchel. And you see the fool getting ready to step out, you know, into the abyss. It always reminds me of that movie, the Indiana Jones movie. I don't know if you remember seeing it, but, you know, there was like, you couldn't see anything. It was invisible, but you had to get to the other side, and you just had to know and have faith and just step out. And when Indiana Jones did step out, there was this invisible staircase that, you know, like little thing that appeared. And see, what we have to understand is when we begin to move outside the limitation of the world of Maya, of the world of illusion, that there are other constructs that are there that your physical senses may not be able to interpret, but there's a higher aspect to yourself that does. We are very, very complex beings, very complex. Mm-hmm. And I have been shown the complexity of it. It's like, oh, my gosh, let me just take a little, you know, narrow it down to a little bit of complexity. But we are so much more than who we perceive ourselves to be. That's the big, big, big illusion, is that we are limited. That's the biggest illusion. And there are those who would keep us under that illusion that we are limited, when in fact we are not. And that's why, you know, the dreams and your sensing and your feelings, you cannot ignore those, because they are part of this something aspect of yourself coming and saying, John, Mary, Joe, Elizabeth, you are more than what you think you are. You know, we can't ignore. And what happens is we get so caught up, Chrissy, in the day-to-day activity and life, we tend to ignore those promptings, just like how I ignored the very clear promptings that said, don't get married to that person. And I ignored it. But see, now to be in this higher, what I call bandwidth of consciousness, it requires you to speak and walk your truth. You really, really have to be authentic. You cannot lie to yourself. And when you have the courage to be authentic and be in your integrity, when you step off the ibis, when you say, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, okay, but all I know is I'm going to be in my authenticity, these magic staircases will all of a sudden appear to get you to where you have to go. You have to be like the fool. You have to know that that little satchel holds all the tools that you need. You've had it all along. But it requires you to go outside of your limitation to realize you're on a new platform of consciousness and awareness now that you can move from. So very important. And when you do that, you know, when I left my first marriage, because I just knew from the beginning that was not, you know, the way to go for me, that is when the universe just opened out. You know, I had to do a lot of different things. It was a very, you know, challenging time, because, you know, he didn't want to leave, and so there was kind of, had to get like an order of protection and go through the family court saga and all of that kind of stuff. And, you know, whatever frequency it was that I said, you know, I just have to be who I am. All of a sudden, I met people. I remember this one gentleman gave me a book about Edgar Casey. I never heard of Edgar Casey before. And then the idea of reincarnation came back. I said, wait a second, I remember this. You mean there are other people who believe like this too? A whole new world opened up, because my world within the world of illusion was even more limited because of my little constraints. And I had to kind of fight my way out of it. And so that was a new platform of understanding. And then from there, is when I made the decision to be a seeker of truth and to be an independent thinker. That was, and that journey has brought me, you know, to where I am today with many stops along the way. But my ministry was with the Spiritual Science Center of New York. It was a very, very, very disciplined, spiritual organization to take this path. In fact, they gave you every reason why you should not be a part of the organization, because they said something that was very true. They said, once you know this, then you're responsible for it. You are responsible for what you know. You can't pretend that you don't know. And now today, like the you know, Occupy Wall Street, there's so many of us. We can't pretend that there's not any corruption and there's any manipulation. There's just too much. We can't pretend like, oh, I can't get involved because I'm too busy. Mm-hmm. We are aware of it. We're responsible for the knowledge that we have. And it doesn't matter if anybody else around you understands it or not. The fact is that you understand it. So you're responsible for it. So now what are you going to do with it?
Absolutely.
You know, that's what it comes down to.
Mm-hmm.
So and it was finding the right situation. You know, first I thought it was going to be with, you know, this particular, you know, maybe Unity or something else. And I tell you, I went to different churches now, and, you know, from temples to what used to bother me too, by the way, when I was little, because I would go to Catholic, Protestant, you name it. If it was any place honoring the higher presence of God, I showed up just to experience it, you know. And this was the other thing that used to bother me when I was little, was this whole idea of separation. Because even now, you could be Christian. However, if you weren't Catholic and you were something else, you know, you're not getting to heaven either. You may get stuck in limbo or purgatory or something like that. But, you know, so I had, my parents, of course, had friends that were not Catholic. The majority of friends were Christian, so they might have been, you know, Methodist or, you know, Lutheran or whichever denomination. So it was, you know, the same kind of conditioning that, oh, not only that, you know, you had to be Roman Catholic, which was different from the Greek Orthodox, you know, Catholic. So what I later realized, I said, my God, this is so fragmented. It's so fragmented.
Right.
And it's like, you know, it's this whole promotion of separation. You are something different than me, you know, and it's all about the ego, the personality is about nothing that's in its real illumined truth. So that bothered me. I actually lost sleep at night because I remember some very beautiful and wonderful people who were part of my life. They weren't Catholic, and I was always concerned, oh, my God, they're not going to get to heaven. You know, I used to like, worry about that. So I said, nah, I can't believe that. That's not true. But, see, you have to come into your own at some point, because what we have done is this, Chrissy. We've handed our power over to a higher authority or a perceived higher authority. You know, the Pope knows this, the priest knows this, you know, the CEO, the bank president, you know. These are higher authority. They are, you know, so much more than who we are. And because what we forgot is that we are divine beings. We are all equal. We're all equal. We have different expressions and propensities and, you know, things that we do. You know, I'm not an accountant, and, you know, I'm going to go to somebody who's good. That they use that part of their brain. You know, I do something else. I use this part of my brain. And individually, we contribute to the whole. Wow, symbiotic. We all work together, doing our part. You know, we all hold a little puzzle piece, and we all click in together. Okay, but what the illusion is of this particular dynamic is that our puzzle piece is independent from all the other puzzle pieces. That's what you say, you know, your puzzle piece is wrong. You're shaped differently than my puzzle piece, when in fact they're supposed to click together because we're one united consciousness. We are all divine beings. So what ended up happening is I started and found the situation I thought that was right for me, because even though, and I was into, you know, the whole positive thinking and affirmations and, oh my gosh, there was a whole new world and visualizations. Anyway, I did the whole thing. And I will tell you that it most certainly has impact. It absolutely does. You know, I said, listen, you don't know the power of affirmations, and, you know, visualizations play an important part. But I want to share, you know, of course, you know, you have the information coming out, you know, like, well, if you affirm it and you visualize it, it's going to happen. And that's not necessarily true. It helps you along your way. But we're so much more than that. It is, I've been shown how complex we are. So say, for example, when somebody got, you know, the secret, and they're listening to the secret, and they're doing everything that they said. They're doing the affirmation. They're holding the emotional response. They're visualizing what it is that they want, and they want this, you know, new car or house or whatever it is that they desire. And then, however, you know, it's not coming as quickly, or it's not coming at all, and they become disillusioned. Well, the positive thinking, the power of affirmation, visualization play an important role. It's better to do it than not do it, okay, because it'll get you along your way. However, it's not the only thing. There's karma, okay, there's certain other dynamics that we are part of that are much beyond, you know, it's our commitments, our spiritual agreements. So it's not just one thing. It's a complexity of things. And it's really kind of following different inner impulses and being true to your soul purpose and its inclinations to push you in a certain direction or to be in a certain way. It really comes down to that. So anyway, I'm in this four-year discipline. We went into theosophy. It was, you know, going through those Alice Bailey books, let me tell you, okay? It was not a piece of cake. You had to be, you know, very dedicated, you know, to the seven rays. And the one thing I will say is that it was 4 years, I mean, of absolute discipline, absolute discipline. You had to be serious about this or you did not deserve there. What's very interesting is that you will see masters, and I put masters in quotation marks, of, you know, teachers that you wouldn't know. You have no idea what they hold of their knowledge. You know, they don't need to boast. They don't need, when you get to a certain point in mastery, you just realize how much you don't know. And then you also, I now reach a point where I can understand years back where sometimes there's just people who cannot have a real dialogue because you're not there yet. It's levels of consciousness, and so sometimes they're just quiet because now they just have to be. So it's sort of like you have to, you know, get to higher frequencies. You know, you can't talk physics to a third grader if you are in your PhD of physics. You know, you just have to wait till the third grader kind of gets into that bandwidth of information. And so I honor that. I understand that now, and I definitely do honor that. And with this now, whatever your path is, whether you are a researcher, you know, whichever path you have chosen to follow your soul urging, you know, your particular puzzle piece, your unique puzzle piece that is part of the higher collective of everything, okay, is that you follow that path because you play a very important role in the scheme of things. And you are responsible for the knowledge that you have. And it commands you to be in your authenticity and in your integrity. And things will come into your life that will push the bar, so to speak. So I always say, when you run into these challenges and you say, oh, my God, you know, I don't, how is this going to happen? And I have to do this, 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 and this. You know, it's a lot to be a multidimensional being in this 3D world. Mm-hmm. But one of the mantras I have said, Chrissy, that I feel that has helped me along my way, I had to start to program. This has been my thing. No limitation, no limitation, no limitation, no limitation. You have to say that over and over and over again, because when you look into your life, it's nothing but limitation. You're told, you know, this is as far as you can get. This is as much money as you can make. This is the only way you can get there. This is, and it's everything is limited, when in fact we're unlimited in our capacity as divine beings. So the mantra of no limitation that I've been saying now for years got me to the point where in 2007, I've always been on a spiritual path, and I always thought, you know, I'm supposed to have like a church or something, you know, I'm supposed to do that. And I was in this part of a church community where I am, and it was the closest thing that I could find, you know, from where my training came from, New York. And it most certainly had to do with the awareness, like my grandmother, who was a medium, that, yeah, when your physical body dies, your consciousness continues. And it's interesting because there's a group of people, including myself, like, yeah, doesn't everybody know that? No. No, not everybody does. So there goes one tier of getting past the illusion, is that there is no death. There is no death. I want to share with you a very direct, you know, experience. Now, as I said, when I was little, I had these, you know, paranormal experiences, and what I now believe to be, you know, maybe loved one in another frequency bandwidth, you know, that came to visit me, or agreements I had in my before physical life here. And but, you know, when my dad died, at his, you know, funeral, just before they closed the casket, I had a pink rose quartz, and I had the family member, my son, myself, you know, my mom and other family members touched that rose quartz. And just before they closed the casket, I put it, you know, in his hands. And sometime later, you know, it was interesting because, don't forget, we are really in this world of illusion, of Maya. It's yucky and gucky. That's the way I can do it. Like, how do you get through from higher ascended realms? It's difficult. Somebody has to, like, be the antenna and the frequency there, you know, to make this connection. So I guess at the time I'm too, you know, involved or whatever it is. You know, I'm busy. I'm working. I'm now a single mom. I'm doing this, that, and the other. But my good friend of mine had a dream. And she couldn't make the funeral, so she had contacted me, and she said, you know, I want to see you, and by the way, I had a dream of your dad. And I said, really? So anyway, I picked her up. We're driving along the way. She says, you know, I saw that in this dream, she's describing the dream, and he's showing me this symbol, this thing in his hand. And she says, you know, I went to Elysian Fields. It's a metaphysical store in my community, and I saw this thing. I mean, she started talking. I actually drove the car on the side because I was just so interested to hear what she had to say. And she had this little box, a little gift for me, and she said, well, I got this because I saw this in the dream of your father. Well, I pull the car over, I get the box, I open it up, and it's the same rose quartz crystal. So Wow. That's just an example, you know, of how our loved ones who are on the other side, what I call on the spirit side, okay, they exist. I have been to that realm myself personally. I have seen that realm. They have meetings just like how we have meetings. I met with a good friend of mine from many years ago who had drowned. I mean, he was like the first friend I had who died. You know, I was in my 20s. His name was Lucius, and I saw him in this place, and it's one of many realms. Now, the thing about the spirit world is that, you know, our grandpa, whoever is in the spirit world, they are still within the gravitational pull of our Earth. And now it's almost coming, it's just that they're on a different bandwidth, and that's the best way analogy I could use. They're on a different frequency. There are times, and we know that our brainwaves, you know, are from beta, you know, theta, alpha. We have different hertz, and there are people who can, who naturally have the ability, I guess, to be in the bandwidth where they can easily communicate. Maybe they have the ability of clear buoyancy where they can see, or clear audiency where they can hear, or clear sentient where they can feel. But basically, it's, again, that kind of communication. And that is in the spirit realm bandwidth of where souls, many souls, from the earth plane, you know, go and have a full existence. You know, you bring your consciousness, whatever your consciousness is in the physical world, you bring that over there. And you continue with your lessons and learnings and, you know, experiences and things like that. A lot of times in our dream state, you know, we tap into that realm. You know, if a lot of times if you have a loved one, I know my dad, when I was just reconsidering of maybe going back to my ex-husband, he came to me in my dream and said, "Oh, no, you don't." But at any rate, they come in with guidance and so forth and so on. So that's a very real thing. And now what I think is so wonderful, Chrissy, is that, you know, this was, what, 20 years ago, you know, there are those people and mediums who ran into a hard time. And, yes, we have to remember this. You're always going to have the people on the fringe. You're going to have the people who, you know, take something that's real and then bastardize it to something that's not. You know what I mean? You have the people who are authentic and you have the charlatans. That's in everything. But it doesn't take away from the seed of truth. And the fact that our loved ones who have passed on from this physical life into another frequency band, mm-hmm. That is consciousness and continued with consciousness, is very real. And there is a communication available between these two worlds. That can definitely happen. What I am thrilled to see is now on TV, every other channel is like a Ghostbuster channel. I can't believe it. You know, I'm very thrilled to see we're on mainstream regular TV, you know, talking about the spirit world, the area where souls that have passed from this 3D reality bite into, you know, another frequency, what they call the spirit world, that's on TV all the time. You know, you wouldn't have seen this 10, 15 years ago, much less 20, 30 years ago, but it's always been there in the Bible, in the Talmud, in all ancient books. They talk about these two worlds and the ability to communicate. That's where the dream stuff, a lot of times they come in our dream state, because in dreaming we are in delta. Our brain wavelengths are at a certain bandwidth, and the communication can come in that way. So once you realize that you're so much more than this little 3D, you know, biological, you know, computer, then it begins to make sense. So at any rate, I was saying I was in this, of course, awareness in this little church community I was in. And in that church community, from a long time ago, and this goes back again from when I was a little small, I started saying, "Father, Mother, God." What we have to understand is as we begin to move into our truth, as we come into our own path and our own awareness, for me it was like, not only does it make sense of the yin and yang, of the balance, and therefore God cannot just be male, or the concept of masculine only, that would be a huge imbalance. The feminine has to play a part here. So from a long time ago, I started saying, "Father, Mother, God," because language, everything impacts. Not only does this Father, Mother, God impact me in terms of how I see things, and it's my perception and my truth and my reality, but as I go out into the world and have the courage to be who I am, I say that too. And I can remember times when somebody would say, "Would you say a prayer? Would you do something?" And I would say, "Father, Mother, God." I always knew that for some people this might be very shocking. Maybe some people may not like it. Or it could be where it's the first concept where people think about it. But it didn't matter. The fact is that it was my authentic thing. And I remember clearly in this particular church community, that was pretty much the hierarchy was very male dominant. The two people who were in charge were both men. And they were, like in anything, you know, even if it's a metaphysical or new age or whatever, there's, you know, certain structures and dynamics and matrices. So when I started saying, they would ask me if I would participate in certain ways because, you know, I was able to, you know, do readings and other things of that nature. And so when I said my prayer, I always say, Father, Mother, God. So I remember one of them came up and said, well, you know, we are a very conservative church, metaphysical church, but conservative. We don't say Father, Mother, God. And I, you know, I said, well, then you can't ask me because I have to say Father, Mother, God. That's my authenticity. Well, it went from that to where I always wanted to do a goddess workshop because, again, I felt it was part of my mission, so to speak, to address this imbalance of what I perceive to be between male and female energies, you know, in this world and on this planet. And the first response was, oh, no, 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 no. No, 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 no. Then the Da Vinci Code came out.
Wow.
And then in the promotion of promoting their educational stuff, you know, the same individual came back to me and said, you know that Father, Mother, God stuff? I said, yes.
Mm-hmm.
He said, well, you know, Da Vinci Code, there's a lot of interest, so maybe, you know, I guess, you know, we could do something like a goddess workshop that you want to do. I said, okay, thank you. Well, I always knew that I was supposed to do this. And sometimes we just got to be patient. We got to be patient, one, for our own development, our own consciousness, also timing for other things. As I said, it's just so complex. But as you hold out there, the universe will bring things about, and there's no way that you could bring it. There's no way that you can orchestrate it. That's why I tell people, look, don't try to figure it out. Just know it'll work out. And when you release that, when they say let go and let God, that's exactly what that is. There's no way you can orchestrate things on certain levels. There's just no way. You have to release it. You have to hold the intention. This is how it's going to be. Perfect timing, perfect, and it will happen. You just got to get out of the way and allow it to happen. And always transcend your fear. And be patient. These are all the little ingredients. So finally, my opportunity opened up. And I remember, you know, saying, oh, how am I going to do this? And in the meanwhile, you know, my 3D world, I was HR director. I did training. I could do curriculum. You know, I've been a writer, you know, and, you know, all the talents needed to where I could do this, you know, easily. And I had an eclectic group of women, actually, that came. It was a goddess workshop. I don't remember the exact name of it, but it was a real interest, and I had people, women from different faiths, you know, from the Hebrew tradition, the Christian tradition, Muslim tradition, very interesting. And I had said to the group, well, this is before, so I said, you know, what book am I going to use? There's like thousands of books that you can use. And I remember going to a very large bookstore. It was called the Main Street Bookstore. It was located in my community here in Sarasota. And I never went up to the top third floor. I was looking at books on the main floor, and there was really nothing there that was really, you know, catching my eye. And for the first time with a friend, I went upstairs. And that's where they had the used books, and there were literally thousands and thousands of thousands. They were just dropping off shelves. They were on tables. They were on the floor. And literally this one book, okay, just fell to my feet. And I looked at it. I picked it up, and I saw a picture of the Earth. It was a very interesting picture, and it, like, the Earth was inside an egg. And it said, it was the, what is it again? It was called the Earth. It was by Barbara Marciniak, and it wasn't her first book. It was her second book. and it was, you know, wisdom from the Pleiades. Now, at that time, I didn't even know what the Pleiades were. I couldn't even pronounce the word, you know, like I don't have no clue what it is, but the book looks so interesting. Meanwhile, I'm looking, you know, for the Goddess Workshop here. I happen to flip open the book, and the page I actually open it up to, I open it up to a chapter that said, the galvanization of the goddess. I mean, it couldn't be any more direct than that. So I said, okay. Now, meanwhile, I said, this is the book. Meanwhile, I'm busy, you know, I'm running, dealing with the 3D world of, you know, Maya. And so I just knew that this was the book. And finally, I flipped the page open and I'm reading the book, and it had to do with the DNA or blood, the feminine thing, some very deep stuff. And, you know, it talked about the sacredness of the women's menses, you know, of their cycle. And I'm saying, oh, man, now I find this out when mine is ending. You know, I was pretty upset. I was like, oh, no, did I miss it? Oh, gosh. Well, do you know what? This is a little mini miracle that I'm sharing. Is that I guess they said, okay, we'll give you one more time. That happened. That was quite amazing. So I said, okay, I got it. Thank you very much. But from that point on, and I think what has happened, when you're in Dharma, I knew I was always got to do a goddess workshop. I had to bring this consciousness. I had to get the energy flowing. And when this opportunity happened, I said to the class, I said, you know, we could do a regular curriculum and we could do this, that, and the other. I said, or why don't we give it to the higher feminine and let we, you know, all of the people there were open that higher information could come in through us, and let's just follow that direction. And everybody agreed. So the book, okay, it's called Earth, the Living Library by Barbara Marciniak, you know, Wisdom from the Pleiades. That was the book. So we worked with this book, and all of a sudden, Chrissy, it was like, first of all, you know, people did different researches from the goddesses from ancient times. So what was coming back was ancient information that we were not privy to. You know, nobody said, oh, by the way, here's the information of the world and this is what happened. In fact, history and herstory has been very distorted and manipulated and kept hidden. And so this is where this research stuff starts to come in. And one of the things that happened, all of us in that class were impacted by the class. But one of the things that happened to me personally is that I got to go back a minute. In the 80s, as I told you, I've always been on a spiritual path. But in the 80s, I consciously said, and this is important for everybody to know, we have choice and we do have power. And I could have gone into the whole thing in the 80s of where, you know, consciousness, it was harmonic convergence. And even at the time of the harmonic convergence, I didn't know what the harmonic convergence was about. I wasn't sure about the alignment. I wasn't sure about all of that stuff. I just felt I should be there. I just felt that I should be there. And the dynamic was, even if you don't understand something, and I've been told that it's not important that you have to understand everything, because we can't, is that the dynamic is that you follow your impulses. So somehow being part of that harmonic convergence also allowed me into the world of channeling, because I remember going to this, I think it was a Christian Science church, and at this church I saw a woman channeling for the very first time. Didn't know about channeling. I remember buying crystals and quartz crystals. And I said, I'm not feeling anything with these things, but I think I should get them. You know, it's just, I'm not sure, but I think I should be doing this. And that was the planting of seeds and my first exposure, you know, to people doing other things that I was not privy to in, you know, my environment, how I was brought up. So, you know, here we go, years and years and years later now, you know, the Goddess Workshop, I now said in the 80s, prior to that, that, you know what, I don't want to do this stuff now. I want to get married and have a career and do blah, 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 blah. But I promise I'll be involved in this. I promise I'll do it, you know, the second half of my life. That was a conscious decision. And do you know,
right,
that was honored. The minute I hit 50, bam, it was like everything came at once. They said, okay, this is what you said. And when I did the Goddess workshop, I literally was downloaded for 7 days. Information, Chrissy, that I did not have before. I can remember lying in my bed and feeling like I'm floating. And you, if those of you have seen The Matrix, Neo, they put this thing in the back of his head, and all of a sudden he knows Taekwondo. You know, that's how it was. It was, in fact, it was so intense. I had to say, whoa, slow down. It was during this time, too, that the awareness of extraterrestrials, you know, I never equated my spirituality with extraterrestrials. And even though in the back of my mind I always figured, yeah, we can't be the only ones, I was never conscious like, oh, yeah, there's a real interaction with extraterrestrials here. I didn't equate the two. I was still, in fact, when I was in that church community I told you about, I was in the bandwidth of, you know, the other side, you know, the spirit side. Somebody in the physical 3D world dies and then they go over there. That was the bandwidth I was at. And it was in there that they said to me, a higher guidance came in and said, oh, no, there's more. I'm like, what? There's more. Look at this. And I was shown the entire galactic universe. I said, there's more? I'm like, wow. So I'm like back in school again. And the Goddess workshop now I'm doing, it's like, oh, honey, you haven't even touched the surface yet. And so that's when my conscious connection came in, like, oh, my God, there are other extraterrestrials in consciousness. The universe is teeming. It's not even a universe. It's a multiverse. I was like a kid. Like, my mouth was open. It's like, what? And so I had to acclimate all this stuff. I had to integrate it. My consciousness went, like, from zip, it quantum leaped, you know, to the 12th power, like in 7 days. And what came in those 7 days, I mean, I could tell you that I have knowledge, okay, that I did not have before. I could read the most complicated. You could give me the most complex thing, okay, for me to read, to understand, and I get it. Now, I didn't even like math in high school, okay, and had to take geometry twice. So the fact that I could do trigonometry, I was downloaded trigonometry in order to understand, you know, certain concepts. And I'm here to tell everybody, we have that ability. We have that ability. So,
absolutely.
So This knowledge came in now that brought me to a whole new platform. And I remember reading a book afterwards, like, you know, acclimated to, oh, yes, you know, and not only that, there's the star families, and you have the Pleiades, you have the Sirians, you know, you have, you know, the group from Orion, you have, you know, the whole universe is teeming with life and different races and so forth and so on. And then when you know that, then that's when you look at your own little planet that you're on, and you can't see any separation. We're all Earthlings from the planet, you know, Gaia. You know,
yeah.
It's that, how can you separate from that perspective? And what's very exciting, I feel, is that consciousness is changing, because for the first time, we are now able to see our beautiful blue-green planet from another perspective. So can you see the difference? You know, way back in, let's talk about, again, the world of illusion. What about those people who thought that the world was flat? What about them? They're like, their whole construct and consciousness was that the world was flat and they could only go so far, because if they went further than that, they would fall off. And what about the consciousness and limitation and illusion where the powers that be at the time said, you know what, the earth is not the center of the universe and the sun does not go around the earth. In fact, we are one of many little rocks that go around the sun. And that is where then you had those people, like the people on Wall Street that had to stand up to the powers, the perceived powers that be in those days, you know, which had the whole religious thing connected to it, and you were a heretic, and, you know, you could be burned at the stake, and I'm sure many of us, if we were back in those days, we were definitely burnt, you know. When I
Absolutely.
Saw the Da Vinci Code, you know, they were killing all the perceived witches because they knew about the earth and the herbs and stuff like that. I said, definitely, I'd be one of those people. Many of us would be, but, you know, can you imagine when Da Vinci and other people who became enlightened and aware and said, you know, that's not right. You know, we evolve and revolve around the sun, not the other way around. And they had to be in their truth and authenticity. Now, a lot of times what had to happen, I'm not saying that you don't have to be discerning. Don't get me wrong. You just don't go ahead and, you know, jump into fire. You may have to plan as to when that fire goes down, or we're going to go around the fire, or above it, or below it. You know, always you must have your powers of discernment, always. So that's where a lot of your mystery schools, you know, that's had came about, is because there was this conflict with so-called science and the religious thoughts of the day. And there were those who sacrificed their life to say, no, I got to stand in the truth, and this is not right, and I'm going to make it happen. There are those that say, okay, we have to do it in another way. We have to go underground and do it. But what a change in consciousness from a flat world of which the sun evolved around us, and we were the highest life forms in the universe.
Right.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh, that's it? To where we can see from the different satellites that are now out in space going towards Mars and, you know, with limitless possibilities that look back and take pictures of the colors, the beautiful colors that are in space, you know, the where we could see our planet from the moon's surface, that changes perspective completely. Completely. So coming from, again, the rise of a global consciousness, which I feel is what's taking place right now on this very auspicious day, coming from the perspective
Absolutely.
That we are one humanity on one planet. And, oh, by the way, the planet is a conscious being. The planet
Absolutely.
Is a consciousness that has a body that has allowed us to evolve on her. And she has a long, long history, and, you know, we've just come fairly recently, and it's a much larger perspective. That's called awakening. That's called beginning to move out of the world of illusion. And I'd like to say that the world of illusion plays its part. You know, everything has a meaning and a purpose, and in the highest realm of things, dark plays its role as well. And dark plays its role in terms of us, you know, getting outside of this illusion. Are there different agendas out there? Yeah, there is. But in the construct of everything, you know, it's all one. And I feel that there's, when it's time for cycles upon cycles upon cycles upon cycles, then there's opportunity, at least in our reality, by you have a choice of saying, I'm going to go this way or I'm going to go the other way. You know, that's which is important. We have to be responsible for our choices. This is part of our expression of contributing to the one source of all that is. So where we are right now, we're saying, look, you have door number one, number two, number three. You know, there is a grand cycle that's moving forward, and I always like to use the quote of Bob Marley, you can't stop the tide, you know, so you may as well just move along with it. Now, how you move along, how you bring it forth, that's the level of where we have choice. We could do it either very bumpy and hard, or we can have this new earth birth as painless as possible. And the painless way of doing it is, first of all, the consciousness that our earth is a living being, that we need to respect our mother and love her and take care of her, that we need to realize that it's not just about me or us and us against them, that we're all on one planet. And being able to see your planet from the perspective of the moon should bring this consciousness together. So, you know, again, these are different levels of awakening. So going along with my little personal path now, you know, I've kind of integrated into this where, as you know, Chrissy, I give lectures and talks and stuff like that. And I talk about, you know, I have to remember that sometimes, you know, information, we have different octaves of information, or people resonate to information on different octaves, and there's some people who are not ready for the information, or some people who are. It's all a mishmash, and it's all good. But most certainly, you know, like if I come across a person that says, gee, I wonder what happens after death, it's like, what? You know, very shocking to me. Like, doesn't everybody know that? But it's now to a consciousness that comes in, you know, that says, you know, we are one consciousness that's part of a planet, and we are broadcasting out there, and we are one life form and consciousness of boundless, limitless life forms and expressions out into the multiverse. And where we are now, what my personal experience has recently been, is that, you know, first I had to, as I learned to transcend my fear, and as I told you, July the 16th, after I did the workshop for the goddess, and, you know, the book came in Earth, the Living Library, Wisdom from the Pleiades, Barbara Marciniak, and then I read all of her books, and then the whole enlightenment came in about, you know, all the other, you know, humanoids that are throughout the universe, as well as non-humanoids. And, of course, I heard about the Zetas, you know, the Zeta Reticuli, you know, the Greys, you know, and then just the Reptilians, and there's Orion, and, you know, and the audience could go and do their own research and all of that stuff over there. But I just became aware of everything. And there was different epochs, and I want to share something that recently, you know, had happened. And so as I'm going on my journey now and went past the fear of saying, you know, I have to anchor light. This is when the anchoring light came in. It came in July 16th of 2007, that some celestial being, some higher intelligence, whether my higher intelligence, divine self, was part of it, and, of course, we're all one, so on some level it was, but I did know that this higher celestial intelligence that came from light, and, again, always be discerning because you have the light and the dark, but I knew this came from light, and the request was to anchor light. Bring those light workers together for two reasons. One, there's a service, need an anchoring of light to the planet, you know, almost like being a transistor radio and locking into a frequency band that comes in. And so that, and then the other part of that was, and it wasn't just me, people all around the world are getting the same information, is that other light workers need to know who other light workers are. And I think that's one of the most wonderful things, because, you know, it's challenging out there in the world when you're among people who, you know, they think you're crazy, you know, and they will lock you up and put you away. You know, so to be among other people that say, yes, I know exactly what you're talking about, it's like your shoulders can relax. You know, mm-hmm. and be able to go in this world and also be aware of another level, you know, of awareness. So I most certainly am most grateful to have the network, and I get along with all people, and that requires us to be with all people. But most certainly I'm in a very comfortable zone with, you know, other star seeds and light workers, because we kind of communicate and understand the same kind of language, no matter how we do it. And all of us have important roles. And even those that may not be what we term star seeds or light workers in their own way, they're contributing to the light. That's all that really, you know, that really matters. But moving along now, you come to the point of realization where I had started to see these very large eyes. And I'm now doing the anchoring light, and I'm getting past my fear, like, what? Is this real? Am I making it up? Am I crazy? You know, and I can't tell you how these higher celestial beings of light have worked with me. They're patients. First of all, they allowed me, didn't do anything. I said, I didn't want to do anything in the 80s. Okay, now they're here. And I said another thing, too. I said, look, I cannot take any shock therapy. You know, I can't take anything shocking. I said, I just got to ease into everything. They honored that also. You know, I just got eased into everything. And so the first thing I started to see were these very black, almond-type eyes. And when I first saw it, I got scared because I associated it with the, you know, with the Zeta Reticuli, with the grays. And I have to tell everybody, we can't say all Zeta Reticuli, all reptilians, all Palladians, all Syrians, or this or that. You know, there's the good, the bad, the ugly, and everything. But after I kind of got over the initial shock of seeing that and realizing this has always been a part of my life on some level, you know, I became peace, had peace with it. I said, because I knew I had to transcend the programming, like, uh-oh, this means this, abductions, da-da-da-da-da. And I said, you know, whatever this is, I don't understand it all. And even if this is a gray, all I know, it's a spiritual gray. All I know is a spiritual counterpart to who I am. And I was absolutely comfortable with that. So it would show up ever so often. And so I just made that connection. Well, at some point, I had the experience where... this is now I'm told to go to, well, this is important. So after 777, which July 16th, you know, 16 is a 7, 2007, which is a 777, the anchoring light, then very clearly on 888, I had an experience. And this experience was where I'm now, what, almost like a year into the anchoring light, and I had a lady come up to me. She was connected with John of God, and John of God does this amazing, you know, healings. He's really a medium, and these entities who serve in healing work through him. I had no knowledge of John of God, and your audience can look up John of God, but he's in Brazil, and he has these certain people that they have these crystals from Brazil to do these crystal beds. And all I know, again, you have to realize, as we all do, we're busy. You know, I have to work, I have a family, and also we have to save the planet, you know, as I always say. You know, so we're busy, busy, busy. And this young lady came up to me and she said, I feel impressed that John of God wants to offer, you know, I want to offer the crystal bed for healing for, you know, light workers, you know, leaders in the light worker community. So I said, I heard the word healing. I said, absolutely. I had no idea what a crystal bed was. I just said, yes, I will do it. On 888, I participated in a spiritual circle where I actually had a participated in a Native American, you know, peace pipe. First time ever with a group of, you know, enlightened women. And then after that, I absolutely remember I had a girlfriend of mine that was having a birthday party, and it was at this place where, you know, drinks and food and dancing, and I went there afterwards. And I happened to meet a woman who was a friend of her friend that was wearing this stone. And I said, wow, what an interesting stone. And she says, well, someone sent it to her from Brazil, and if I ever heard of John of God. And see, the reason why I bring this up is that we have to be always aware of the synchronicities and the divine clues that come our way, because those are the little spiritual breadcrumbs. So I said to her, oh, my gosh, how interesting. You should say that. I just heard his name this week, and I'm going to have some kind of healing on Monday, you know, with John of God. When I went home that night, during this period of time, I wasn't dreaming. I did not remember any dreams whatsoever. None. It was like a void. I go to sleep and nothing. And this particular night, I did have a dream. And in the dream, you know, I just saw a lot of, like, these little munchkin people, really. They look very small to me. They were looking for me, and then they bring me into this room, and I see this guy in a big chair, and he's kind of like a big guy with dark hair, and we're talking to each other, and we're saying something like, I'm saying, yeah, well, I'm thinking the consciousness of the people is changing, some sort of dialogue like that. Anyway, the Monday, I work, you know, I get over to this lady's house for this crystal bed healing. You know, I lie in this bed, and what it is, it's quartz crystals from Brazil, and they're lighted up according to the colors of the chakra. And, you know, it was very relaxing. I just, you know, lay down there, and I said, you know, it's nice. And just to have the space not to, you know, just to be quiet, which was great. So after the session was over, I said, well, thank you. You know, I feel pretty good. You know, everything was, you know, nice. And then I see a picture, and I look at the picture, and I said, who's this? And she said, that's John of God. And there goes this guy who I saw in a dream. And I said, well, I saw him in this really big chair. She said, in Brazil, he sits in a very large chair as people go by. And you can, you know, check out John of God for yourself and how that whole thing works. I won't go into that. But what I will tell you is that 2 days later, I actually called my mother. And I said, oh, my God, I had a profound healing. Because one of the things that we have to do also, Chrissy, is that as these energies are coming in, we got to be consciously aware of our physical body and honor our physical body. You know, for me, I've been more into mind, and, like, sometimes I forget I have a physical body, like, oh, yes, that's right, I have a physical body I have to address. But really, it's integrating everything, our right and left brain, our spirit, physical, emotional, and physical bodies is the integration holistic. So these are all different dynamics that have to come into play, including healing the physical, the mental, and the emotional bodies. So that was very profound. And then in that time, 888, telepathically, it came very strong that I and others are to go to Peru for 999. Now, what you have to understand is this. Peru, huh? South America, not even on my radar. About the only thing I knew about Peru was, you know, Machu Picchu was there. That was it. No other conscious connection of Peru. Didn't know about the Incas, didn't know about, you know, the Aymara, the Quechua, you know, Lake Titicaca. In fact, what came in was to go to Lake Titicaca, and I couldn't even get the name, Tata Tutu, Titi Tata.
Yeah.
I'm like, what is this? I guess I missed school the day they talked about Lake Titicaca because I didn't even know it existed. So anyway, of course, later on, again, fear. What? How do you? I don't know anybody in Peru. I don't even know where to begin. Where do you start to say, 999, we're going to be at Lake Titicaca? Okay, where do you even go? Well, this was, you know, all the lessons. When I released the fear, like I released the fear to do the anchoring light, you know, and just do it. Okay, you don't have to understand everything, just do it. And I just gave the agreement to say, okay. And a minute I said, okay, I don't know how, but somehow it's going to happen. And that's exactly what happened. A lady came up to me, and she said to me, that she lived in Peru for years. She's always wanted to do a sacred journey to Peru. I said, well, here's your chance. So she got an opportunity to fulfill her dharma. Okay, she was the person that was the key contact that orchestrated everything. And the trip was a spiritual quest. It had a very specific thing. The trip was beyond perfect. That's all I can say. There's no way, you know, I orchestrated this. No way, no how. This was absolutely done on a higher level. So there was a group of us. It was a very profound, because there was a group of us, and if any of you have read the Celestine Prophecy.
Celestine Prophecy, yes.
Yes. In that book, it talks about how divine synchronicities happen. And when we are now in Peru, we get there, we had from people of all ages, the oldest was age 76, nobody got sick, everybody was fine. It was the most perfect perfect trip. There's no way this could have been orchestrated on whatever level. The right people, you know, everything was just perfect for what this was to be. And we were in the area of Amaruru, which is, they call the Stargate. And it's this giant door that's cut into this mountain. It's just amazing. So we were there, sacred grounds, and this is all pre-Inca stuff. And so while we're there, here comes a group walking down and with their shaman. And the shaman knew, you know, the guide that we were with, and they start talking. And then we said, you know, join us for this meditation. And about of all the people who sat next to me was this one lady, the only one that spoke English, because everybody else was speaking Spanish there. And after the meditation, I turned to her, her name was Maria, and I said, you should be with us tomorrow, which was 999. And spoke to them and talked about 999, and we were going to be in this little island called Anapia, which nobody has heard of. And they changed their plans in that moment. This is how you start surrendering to the higher power, you know, let go and let God and just be the vehicle for this stuff to unfold. And so now the next day, we, or this new group who changed their plans in that day, we're now all going to this little island of Anapia. It is the area of the Amara people whose lineage goes back thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago. We get into this little island, and these people for the first time are hosting, you know, people outside of their environment. So I think we were the first Americans that were there, and we were the guests of this lovely, I and a roommate was at the guest of this lovely lady and her home. And everything there, you know, was from the land. You know, you see Lake Titicaca, the fish come right from there. So one of the things, you know, because you're up like 12,000, 13,000, and 14,000 feet above sea level. And, you know, they know to chew the cocoa leaves, you know, to keep, you know, your energy up. But also, I was just amazed at the strength that we all had. And I really think that has to do with the food, what the original purpose of food was to give you the nutrients that you need. They have no chemicals in it. It comes directly from the land. And, yeah, when you eat, you have strength. I said, oh, that's what food is supposed to do. I almost forgot because it was so different. And the food tasted different. It was nutritious, and it was made with love. And so on the day of the 999, we get into these boats. We're all dressed in white. We're going to this little island of Anapia. We all climb up to the top, to the summit of this little mountain. Well, it's like a hill, but, you know, for us it was like a mountain. And we're on the top, and we're looking over Lake Titicaca. And prior to that happening, the night before, I wanted to mention, the people, which are about 300 people that live on this island, they had like a little community center, and they invited us to come, you know, for us to all to meet. It was just amazing about how the feeling of community was there. And so we go, including the group from Lima, because they were from Lima, the group that said we met at the Amaruru Stargate. And we all sat down through the interpreters. Each one of us said why we were there. And so it all came in. Here you have this very ancient people, the Amara people, okay, that, you know, what are the chances to running into them? Okay, it was definitely a point of destination. And we said we are here because we were called to come and raise the frequency, okay, and out of love of Pachamama, which is what they call our Earth Mother. The people from Lima said that they were there in service to Pachamama, our Earth Mother. And the people from the Amara people from this island of Anapia said they are there in honor of Earth Mother Pachamama. We all converged on 999. What are the chances? Because we were there in service to our Earth Mother. And when I when we did this on 999 and did a channel and, you know, said the prayer, you know, our intention of raising the frequency into light, that there are those here with Earth Mother who want peace, who want love, who want light, okay, and the group from Lima participated in that, and you had the people from the island of Anapia come and do this, and then the shaman in the Andean, the traditional Andean spiritual way of expressing, they did their spiritual, you know, expression, and which is a very specific kind of way to do it. So here we had different cultures conversion into one place, all with the same purpose, all for the same reason of being there, and expression, expressing our devotion to light and love in our own unique way. It was powerful. It was powerful. Now,
it sounds wonderful. Let me just stop you for 1 second. We're going to go into archive. The end of the show is in 10 seconds. Mm-hmm. And I just want to tell the listeners and the people in chat that you can hear the whole 3 hours in about 1 hour and 10 minutes from now. Thank you. Go ahead. Go ahead, Sharon Elizabeth.
Okay. So now when we come back from that experience, I did not realize this, Chrissy, until much later, that in 1979, this is so huge, it was a very psychic year for me in 1979. And 1979, by the way, is when, you know, I left, you know, my first husband and, you know, did that whole thing. And when the universe started to open up and all of that stuff. And, you know, went back to college and, you know, started on with my life as a seeker of truth and independent thinker. And in 1979 was an extremely psychic year. And this whole concept came to me, what I call the universal cause. And the universal cause was a symbol. It's actually the phi symbol, where there's a circle and one line. And the message that came to me was about there is one God for all things. What it was, and in those days, we didn't use the vocabulary unity consciousness, you know, or oneness, but that's what it was. And it was so compelling that I had to write this down, and I copyrighted it. And back in 1980, it was copyrighted in 1980, you know, you had to get an attorney, and it isn't like how it was easy, but you had to send this out to 100 people. So back then, they already knew I was crazy. But anyway, I did this. And during this time, it came to me, I saw clearly there was a group of people on top of a hill or a mountain, and they were praying, and they were saying, you know, we want to raise the frequency. It was somehow important to raise the frequency of our Earth Mother, so we will be in alignment, so we will be in harmony with a higher cycle of cosmic dynamics. And at the time, I thought that the leaders were like, you know, heads of state and so forth. Well, it isn't until after the experience in Peru that my memory comes back and say, wait a second, this is familiar. And I go back to 1979 when I saw this. The difference was, here I'm thinking it's the world leaders that are doing this, when in fact it's not. It is us. We mm-hmm. are the ones that we're waiting for. We are the leaders. It's us. So that was a huge, huge awakening. Now, when I'm in Peru, I get the information, you'll be back. Again, 10, 10, 10. Okay, and I'm thinking, well, I'm back to Peru, and, you know, who do I contact? And again, completely out of my hands, I'm guided to contact a guy by the name of Luis Fernando Mojitos, who is a ET contactee. He doesn't speak English. I don't speak Spanish. He doesn't know me. I don't know him. He's traveling all around the world. You know, the message that he gets with the Great White Brotherhood and his, you know, contactees. And through the most amazing dynamic, okay, I get a group together for 10-10-10 to be in Pumapunku in Bolivia with this guy. And it was just extraordinary how it all came together, but it did. And the purpose of this trip was to receive codes. This was a very specific thing, to receive codes. Now, the Great White Brotherhood, you know, also known as the Ascended Masters, also known as the Spiritual Hierarchy. You know, I've heard it again, like, you know, before, you know, you really connect with the ET awareness. You kind of hear it, but it's not like a real conscious connection thing. And the same thing was going on. In fact, I got a book about the Great White Brotherhood and never got to read it. I now look back on my life and just say they've been there all along. So finally, it takes two trips to go to Bolivia to receive these codes, where I have a interdimensional, truly interdimensional communication. And when I had sent the information out about this trip to Bolivia, and this is where you got to transcend your fear. This is where you have to transcend personality, the ego, and all of that. Basically, the trip said, what is the experience is going to be an interdimensional experience. Now, you know, I'm still have a very conservative side to myself, Chrissy, and, you know, I do a newsletter called the Anchoring Light Newsletter. And for me to really put out there, we're going to have an interdimensional experience, that's what this trip is about, at least from my perspective, took some courage to put it out there like that.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, I did. And we have the pictures. We have the people who were there, which is only a small groups of people. We don't take large crowds because this kind of stuff, you can only take a small handful of people for this kind of, you know, energy that comes in. And it was a true initiation into a conscious dialogue, if you will, communication, connection with Ascended Masters. And you can read and see what are Ascended Masters. These are beings who had an earth experience, who have transcended, you know, the cycle of life and death, and they, out of their compassion and love, are within or looking after our earth, our planet, and helping us. And what happened is that we had this initiation, and it was very ancient, and the whole trip of Bolivia was just, you know, just phenomenal. That's the only word I can say, and magical. We stayed in the alpha state. I mean, it was completely ethereal, the entire experience there. And we have pictures, you know, to prove this interdimensional experience that we had. But when I come back now, okay, we're changed. I'm changed. And then a new tier of information comes in. One is that, remember I talked about, I always thought I was supposed to have a church or a center or something.
Mm-hmm.
And it was that years ago they said, no, not yet, because there's so much more. Well, here the concept of the universal cause that I had, you know, back in 1979, remember back then, oh, this issue must really be crazy. I forgot all about that. And now Bolivia says, 30 years later, now it's time. Now it's time. So very much I'm on a very specific, myself and others and those that are going to be drawn to this, Chrissy. There's some unfolding that's taken place regarding this request. And the request, let's talk about that. Now, remember the eyes, okay? Remember the eyes I've been seeing. At first I was scared and da-da-da-da-da. Okay. Now I'm at a new bandwidth of consciousness, awareness, whatever. And finally, the eyes reveal who they look like. And what I saw was this, had an out-of-body or altered state, I would say, an altered state. And I remember my body being very, very tired because I did a lot of exercise, but my mind was very active. So to make these connections, a lot of it has to do with the brain wavelength. And during this time, too, before I went to Peru now, which was for 999, you know, I read a book. I was guided to read stuff that was maybe written 20, 30 years ago. But at the time, it wouldn't have been relevant, whereas in the moment, it was relevant then. And I read a book called A Date with the Gods. And really, this is the precursor to Shirley MacLaine's book, Out on a Limb. And one of the things on there was, of course, the ability to, you know, project your consciousness and, you know, travel. And I was like, well, I want to do that. But, you know, in the book, there was this Palladian Rama that was helping, you know, her subject to do that. And I said, well, he had somebody. Well, don't you know? I had the experience. And I literally could tell you what it was like being drawn out of my body. Then I see this very petite, attractive young lady, and she's with me. You know, and I'm flying over New York and seeing the rooftops, and I remember looking up at the moon, and I'm just so excited that I'm doing this, and, you know, and then when I came back into my body, I remember clearly that happening. I'm looking at her, and then all of a sudden, I can no longer see her when I came back into the body, but I felt her. And in the meanwhile, I said, who are you? Who are you? And then, of course, my memory comes back. Oh, my gosh, that's the Palladian Rama, you know, because she heard me say, well, I wish I had somebody to help me. She came around and helped. So that was great. So now, you know, with Bolivia, what's happening is that now the eyes, and I finally see the eyes are attached to the most beautiful face. It's very, very large, black, liquid black almond eyes, kind of almost looking like the traditional thing that you would see of an extraterrestrial, you know, with the slanted black eyes. But the bone structure was just absolutely beautiful. And I looked, you know, they showed me the face, like facing them, and they also did a profile. And on the profile, it had sort of a bit of an elongated head. In the meanwhile, I have to interject, I'm exposed to the crystal skulls now that I didn't really know before. And there's a crystal skull called Max, and I see Max, and I have a real experience with that, and it's activated, and I have a little crystal skull that's made of labradorite that is in tune with that, that I keep with me now. Anyway, so this is like little gaps in between. So now I am actually seeing, okay, the being who's been with me all these years, but now I realized, they say, look, I think you're ready that you could see what I look like. And they're beautiful. It's just they look different from us. You know, so maybe 10 years ago I might have freaked, whereas now it's like, oh, hi, how are you? You know, and then they showed me our galaxy. I saw it in a horizontal position as well as a vertical position, and they showed me the planet Saturn. Okay, and at the time I'm like, why they showed me the planet Saturn from two different angles. And really, all it was, no fear whatsoever. I was just observing it, realizing that this is a communication on, you know, whatever level. And, you know, that was the end of it. But right around this time, too, I had very clear, don't forget, Anchoring Light is continuing, meditation every Monday. It is now the energies coming through in that experience and the people who are drawn to be there. And it changes every single Monday. It's just, you know, quantum leaping to new levels of, you know, energies and guidance. And I finally say, you know, who are you? I've always said, who are you? So it doesn't matter. You know, it's just bringing in these energies. So now I see the face, and they were luminescent white. Do not believe that that is their true color, but to come into the 3D world, they come kind of looking with this luminescent light. So, you know, I'm good with it. I'm like, fine. And then I get the clear instructions, just like how, you know, the Goddess Workshop, of doing remote viewing class. Now, I know nothing about remote viewing. Nothing. Okay, but what? What? Again, you know, don't question, just follow. And it was a group of 13. It was for 13 weeks. And don't you know, the information came in. All of us got upgraded to some degree, which is how then I now go to, Bolivia. This was before we went to Bolivia. I now realize that that helped with the interdimensional communication. It's just amazing when you look back to see how these steps unfold into a particular purpose and singularity. And so now what's happening is fairly recently I see this being again, but with a group. I clearly see a ship. And I have remote viewed in the past and have seen ships and symbols. And I actually know about Mars, and how I got to know about Mars is the Earth Mother is the one, she has a consciousness and she can communicate and says, hey, there's a relationship with Mars. And had the ability at one point to, like, wow, there's some pyramids down there. Later on, find out that NASA and, what's his name, Richard Hoagland, I think he's very much into the whole Mars thing, that in the area of Sidonia, there are pyramids there. Well, I actually saw them, you know, remotely. Mm-hmm. And so I said, hey, there's something going on, you know, where that's concerned. But in the meanwhile, what's happening with me is I now have a face, you know, to this particular guide. This guide comes back with a whole group, and the face is around this, I guess what you call a saucer-shaped ship. And they all look the same. You know, I'm like, wow, they all look the same identical face. But what's different now is sort of like on the side of this vision. And again, no fear, just observing. And I'm seeing the light coming from the ship, like coming down. And it's like some filaments of light. And I'm really observing, like, wow, that's how that's done. I'm trying to figure it all out. But what I see on the left towards the back is this master, this who I impressed was a master, and the hands are up. And I said, is that Jesus? You know, to myself, I said, I think that's Jesus. Now, during the Anchor and Light stuff, what you have to understand is that I've never been like, you know, a Jesus person in the sense that, of course, I was, you know about Jesus, honor and love Jesus, you know, the person who was here 2,000 years ago to bring awareness and has always been a way shower for me, because I said, look at him trying to talk the truth, and they look what they did to him. So whenever I ran into challenges, one of the things, the story of Jesus that has been illumined throughout my life is that you never give up, because there's always the resurrection. You know, but to say that I was a person, because I appreciate all masters, I was never just Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Mm-hmm. And if anything, I had, I would say, a real connection to Mother Mary, you know, the feminine aspect of God and the goddess. So now, so whenever Jesus would kind of show up, I'd always be like a little shocked, like, oh, you know, hi, how interesting. Well, this time now, very synchronistically, I remember hearing about this book called We the Arcturians by Norma Manelovic. And I said, you know, one of these days I got to read that book. The book was written in the 80s. And right after I had this dream, this book happens to come into my hand. Someone gives me the book. And when I held this book, I knew that it was going to be life-changing, that there was going to be information. It was just too synchronistic how all of this happened. For this book, for me, again, my life, busy, 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 busy. And during, in between sleep, I just had to read the first couple of pages. And it said about the Arcturians, what they look like. They all look the same. And finally, they have revealed who they are and their connection to the Ascended Masters, and in particular, Sananda, who is, no, that's the spiritual name in the fifth dimension and above, who was Jesus the Christ in the earth plane, you know, 2,000 years ago. This entire book was a tremendous trigger for me, because what, wherever I was, and for it to come into my life at this particular time, I'm not like a cryy kind of person, you know. I have a strong mental, you know, capacity, and of course I have empathy and, you know, feelings. But you know how some people could burst out crying. I'm not that type of person. But I cried and cried through this entire book. And I could only take little doses at a time, because one of the things it did, it triggered my cosmic memory, which is huge, because everything changes. I remember my agreements. I remember the Ascended Masters. I remember Sananda, Serapis Bay, Kuthami. I remember Mother Mary, Kuan Yin, Mary Magdalene, and a group of others who maybe I don't know their names at the moment, but I remember this group. I remember the group that brought me to the Andes, to Lake Titicaca. And there's different places around the planet where they have their strongholds, for lack of a better word, or where they kind of focus, and, you know, different groups of people. And they all work together on behalf of all humanity on the planet. That's a huge, huge, huge awakening. And so, you know, when that happened, and for those that feel compelled or resonate to what I'm saying, I urge you to get this book. And you have to get through it, because now, remember I told you about the planet Saturn, and, you know, I wasn't sure what that was. Well, they have a ship called the Athena, and Edgar Cayce talks about the Arcturians. They are one of the most advanced civilizations in our Milky Way galaxy. And they come from the place of oneness, of unity. Remember the universal cause from 30 years ago? Hey, it's all one. Just the highest of integrity, you know, just unconditional love. And by the way, let me revert back, because that's an important thing I wanted to share with your audience, is this was, you know, during the time I was shown the, this was around the Gulf oil spill. And I was shown what Maya, what the world of Maya illusion was like. And I was in this oil slick, and it was yuck and mucky. And then all of a sudden, this golden rope with a knot at the end of it, I remember it so clearly, was sent down, and I held it, and it pulled me out of the muck. And then I'm climbing up these glistening rocks, because there's water that's flowing down these rocks, and I'm not afraid of slipping. I'm just, you know, climbing up these rocks, and as I'm climbing, I'm getting lighter and brighter. You know, the rocks and the water are getting lighter and brighter, and it's washing over me. And then at some point, this white Pegasus is, you know, is the horse with the wings. And, mm-hmm. you know, it comes over. It's offering its assistance. I get on the horse. It takes me up to another level. I get off. I climb up a little bit more. And then I find myself in this, like, ethereal temple. It's just beautiful. And I'm looking, and in the, like, up on top, I see a diamond light. But within this diamond light, I can discern the outline of a feminine form. And in my mind, you know, it was the divine feminine, or in my mind, it was Mother Mary. And I got a very clear message that I want to share with the audience, because it's really important, as to how to move forward, as we birth our planet to a new age of peace and light. And she said that we must walk the middle path and keep the polarities in balance. Somebody needs to keep the polarities in balance, okay? And she emphasized unconditional love and non-judgment. The non-judgment was absolutely key. And when I got this information, and I share it in the anchoring light, what she said, you know, walk the middle path, holding the polarities in balance, non-judgment, unconditional love. Those are the instructions. And do you know that I have been trying to do that, so I can't get caught up into the Republicans and the Democrats. I can't get caught up into them and us. I cannot promote anything. You know, you get stuff on the internet. I cannot promote anything that's not coming from oneness. I can't. So no longer I engage in any of that stuff, because I realize that, you know, we're on a frequency above that, and we need to promote that we're all one. So I don't get caught up in that. But taking that non-judgment perspective is where, when I was in Bolivia, and we all had this experience, but I saw the faces, you know, of all those that seeded our planet and our humanity, and a lot of downloads came in. I was inside the body of a snake, somehow the brotherhood of the snake plays an important role. But one of the things I did see for the very first time were reptilians. And of course, you know, just like the Greys, there's a lot of stuff about them. And again, non-judgment. And through that information of non-judgment, information came to me and say, yeah, you know, there are some reptilians that do this, that, and the other, just like how there are humans that do this, that, and the other, but they do not all, okay? And so, you know, again, it was the whole thing of non-judgment, which is how information has come in, and bandwidths of information comes in now, because I've been truly trying to follow that non-judgment thing. If you're judgmental, then you're going to screen and filter out information. So again, it's the idea of what the Blessed Mother said to be, is to be non-judgmental and unconditional love. And if we're going to keep balance, somebody's going to have to hold the balance, correct? Okay, mm-hmm. So you can't swing those back and forth kind of things. You know, we have to watch very little TV to make sure our emotions don't go swinging back and forth. You hear things, you know, you want to kick the TV in. You know, that all of that stuff is just playing into that energy, which we don't want that to happen. We need to kind of, you know, keep the oneness consciousness there. And that's what the Arcturians are all about. So the Arcturians, which now I know play, you know, the Galactic Federation of Light works with many, many of us you know, and you have just wonderful conscious beings, you know, from the Palladians and from the Syrians and, you know, from all over various, you know, places and realms and so forth. But they work very closely with the Ascended Masters. And that was the key. So now what has happened is I'm very well aware the anchoring light meditation now has reached a frequency band of Ascended Master frequency. And, you know, things go by octaves. I could talk for hours of some of the information they shared, but I don't know how much time we have left. But let me give you a couple of snippets of recent information I received.
Half an hour. I just want to say half an hour.
Okay, so I'm going to go real quick here. So now, you know, you're on a new bandwidth. I'm on a new bandwidth of information. You know, each little tier is like, oh, wow, next tier. Oh, wow, next tier. Okay, it's that kind of thing. And I am now, and many of us, are under new instructions. They're saying, okay, now there's a new paradigm, okay? And, for example, I've always been a person who set goals. You know, it was a tool that has served me in my life where I would set goals and have timelines and, you know, to accomplish this and so on and so forth. And they said, no more. Don't do that anymore, which I got to tell you is very difficult to me. So I'm so ingrained, you know, into doing that. And, you know, you have the left brain, the right brain, and, you know, getting this all together, not a piece of cake. You know, there's effort involved in this. And the reason why they said the idea of goal setting, now, of course, you have a direction. I'm not saying not having any discernment or anything like that. But what they were telling me is like, oh, you know what, this will be accomplished. I'm going to do that by, you know, December 31st. And, you know, the next thing I'm going to do, this, that, and the other. They said what that does is that it promotes and ingrains linear time. And linear time is an illusion. And they said now you have to think in term, and they told me that it was a spiral. It's as time as a spiral. Okay, so that was, you know, one thing. The other thing I'm very aware of now is that I bring back sometimes my dream state and so-called waking state blends one into the other. You know, what I tell people is just to kind of stretch their mind. Who's not to say that this reality bite is a dream?
Mm-hmm.
That we're really sleeping somewhere else and this is all a dream. You know,
yes,
so it causes you... Yeah, it causes you like, wow, you know, that's heavy. Let me think on that.
Absolutely.
You know, we're,
you're right on it. You're right on
so,
it.
Right, so we're, you know, what's the difference between one reality bite to the other reality bite? And that brings in our multidimensionality, where I've had little snippets in the past, but most certainly alternate realities, you know, parallel universes, you know, existing simultaneously on different dimensions at one time, you know, soul fragments being to move from one to the other, all the different timelines, you know. There are certain movies that I really liked, and my son and I, this is so interesting, we had watched the book Back to the Future, and there's a trilogy, and what I like about that movie, it, you know, a lot of times, this is the other thing about movies. If it can be conceived, that means it is achieved somewhere. It's happening somewhere. So before, when I was younger, I always used to think science fiction was a future reality.
Mm-hmm.
And now I think science fiction is happening someplace. So I always watch things carefully, you know, ideas and concepts carefully, because if it can be conceived, that means it's achievable on some level. So the Back to the Future really went into timelines. And so you could have multiple outcomes and multiple timelines. So one of the things that I experienced was, you know, actually seeing a life of mine. It was a different husband and a different son and a child. And I remember the location, and come to find out years later, years and years later, that the location that I didn't physically see, but when I went to Peru, you know, they have those little DVDs where you could see the country, you know, the different sites. And we stayed in the area of Lake Titicaca. We didn't really go further north of Lima, like to the Nazca lines or into the sea area.
Mm-hmm.
But I did get this little tape, DVD, and I was looking at it, and it showed the seacoast, which was north of Lima, and the seacoast was the exact location where I had this experience years ago. I'm like, oh, my God. And then what you realize, you know, Peru, like I said, and I've been to Egypt. You know, I was with the Egypt, with the Rosicrucians. You know, I was very much, you know, there's a whole thing that I even go in with that, with Thoth. One of the key things that happened to me, by the way, as a precursor to the whole goddess energy thing, is I was given the Book of Earth. Now, I think this is important, so I'm thinking about it. Let me go back to this real quick. This is the awakening part. This is when I was downloaded, you know, all the information as I was starting to do the goddess, being in my dharma. And that's why people need to be in whatever the dharma that they're supposed to be, because things will begin to open up. And very clearly, I had a dream experience where, and I shared this with somebody, and they had a similar thing, and they knew what I was talking about. So that's always interesting. But at any rate, it was like, you know how you would have the Roman Colosseum, you know, the rounded thing, and it can hold thousands and thousands of people. And I find myself in this kind of location, and it's thousands and thousands of beings are there. And there's like the middle of the place is lit up, and something important is going to happen. And next thing I know, I'm walking towards the middle of the stage, and I see this being, and this being is huge. And I can't remember the face. All I could, my eye level just hit the shoulders of this being. And I'm giving this book, and it's a big book, and I have it on a podium, and I open up the book. Now, I went to Egypt with the Rosicrucians, oh, years and years, 25 years prior. I was attracted to these ibis bones. And it's another story, but I was like, oh, should I have them? Shouldn't I have them? Should I have them? Shouldn't I have them? Anyway, I went through stuff with that, but I've kept them on the altar, sometimes inside of it, sometimes on top of it. But anyway, so 20 years later, 22 years later, I have this dream experience, and as I open up the book, I see Thoth, the Egyptian god, Thoth. And as I continue to look at the book, it's not in hieroglyphics. The way I could say it is like in color. And it wasn't a communication where, you know, my eyes are reading something. It was more of an emotional information. It was a different form of communication. But as I flipped through the pages of this Book of Earth, that's when my awareness, I was like, what? What? Oh, my God, what? I was shocked. I was like, oh! It was like this, I didn't know this was going on planet Earth. Well, after that experience is when my son was getting ready to go to China on the people-to-people program, and which was started by President Eisenhower. And President Eisenhower had a quote on there that just, I was fixated on the quote. And the quote he said was, the purpose of the people-to-people program was for people to go to other countries and meet other people from other countries to promote peace and you know, good relations, because governments never will. And I said to myself, how odd. What do you know, meanwhile I have the rose-colored glasses, you know, the illusion, like, doesn't everybody want world peace? Isn't that what the governments want? They want world peace, you know. And so when I realize now this dream experience was the information about Earth, it's like, no, there's a whole group that doesn't want world peace. There's a whole other thing that's going on. And then I see in my dream President Eisenhower, and I will tell you, point blank, it was President Eisenhower in my dream state that said, hey, sweetie, let me bring you up to speed on what's going on. And I was like, I had no idea. So that's when I realized, you know, all of this stuff. Now, one other important thing I forgot to mention during this time, too, which is critical. So I'm beginning to awaken, like, oh, my gosh, this is what's really going on. You know, the illusion and delusion is now going away, that, you know, this has been going on for millions of years. You know, the manipulation, there's an agenda, you know, and there's an agenda to keep us disempowered, to keep us under control. And when all of this, you know, happens, this was a very critical time because I received a letter. And I am sure many who are listening to this might have received the same letter because this letter is targeted to a particular group of people. And the letter comes in like a par avion envelope, you know, the old-time red and blue border par avion. So when I took the letter out, it looked like very strange. I remember it said Henderson, Nevada, and I open up the letter, and the letter is 6 pages long. Okay, now, you know, I have a busy life. You know, this has to be bullet. My life information should come to me in bullet points, okay? This was 6 pages long of dialogue. I read the beginning and didn't stop reading till I got to the last sentence of the 6-page letter. That's how compelling it was. Mm-hmm. And it talked about, it was very cryptic, and it talked about, have you sensed that there's something else going on, that there's another world, and this is the world of illusion, and this, that, and the other. And basically it talked about the power of your mind, and you can do things, and if you knew who was part of this secret organization, the most powerful in the world, and if you do this, it would be for you and your descendants only. And then it went on to say something where I got this, like, pit in my solar plexus. It says, you don't have to worry about the earth changes. You and yours will be protected. Basically saying, yeah, we'll be fine, and the heck with everybody else. Well, when I read that part, I didn't like that part. I had a bad feeling. Well, this was the exact same time when the Goddess Workshop, you know, was going to do that, and when the book came, and I was in very much communication with the Palladians. They orchestrated, and one of the things that they said, clear as day, you could tell the difference between light and dark. Light is inclusive, dark is exclusive. And what I came to find out, and this was after 2 years, that this letter came from the Illuminati. Okay, they came from the Illuminati. And, of course, those of you, you know, who already know about it, or if you don't know about it, you could do your own research on the Illuminati. So the whole thing, you know, the letter was like, shh, don't tell anybody. You know, stroking the ego, this is for you, you're special, only you and yours, and you'll have this, and, you know, forget everybody else. And, of course,
yeah,
those
get
of
a
us
lot of emails, channeled
life.
Emails,
and
just
the whole
like
idea
that.
Is that we are here to serve the planet and all of her life forms, all of
right.
her life forms. So, you know, I made the conscious decision, and I really took it all the way up to the brink. I was just curious. You know, this is a time I wasn't, you know, having the knowledge I had then. And of course, I wasn't going to be a part of that. That's not why I came here, you know, coming here to bring forth light. And the thing about it was that, do you know that I have all the knowledge, well, a very large portion of the knowledge, okay, of what they were talking about and alluding to, and I didn't have to take that path. I didn't have to take it. I took the other path. Knowledge is knowledge. What you do with it is the issue. How you use it is the issue. You know, is it for self-serving purposes or is it for the benefit of all? You know, that's basically it. And the self-serving purposes is when you're still caught up in the ego and the personality. And the ego and the personality, which is a whole different subject, you know, as part of the illusion, as part of, you know, that whole thing. It's transcending the ego and the personality. But easier said than done. Easier said than done, you know. So, you know, you come to a point of awareness and consciousness, which brings us back to, you know, Occupy Wall Street, you know, the 9/11. Okay, 9/11, it was crystal clear to me. I'm from New York. I mean, the 9/11 experience affected all of us, but most certainly I will tell you it was in my face because where I lived in New York, I lived in Brooklyn, right across from the World Trade Center. In fact, I used to get free HBO because I was so close to the antenna. It was just part of my life. I went to parties there. I went to school there. I had friends who worked there. Intricately a part of my life. I saw the World Trade Centers being built when I was going to high school. I saw it, the cranes on top of them going up, up, up. And then on 9/11, you know, 2001. I was responsible for the principal who was at the elementary school where President Bush was at. I recruited her from Virginia, my company. So, and the day I was going to, as an HR director where I was going to in my current company, I got caught up in the presidential, cars and all of that, and I was running late to get to my office, and I remember calling my office up and saying, you know, we were going to do a special training, some HR software, and so I told the staff, I said, you know, you guys go ahead, you know, without me. I'm caught up in this traffic because of President Bush, you know, being in this elementary school of the principal who I recruited years back. Very synchronistic. Then I'm listening to a station, and my first awareness of it was the station had said that someone from New York had called up and said a plane hit the World Trade Center. I'm like, oh, my gosh. So anyhow, by the time I did get to my office, you know, went directly to the computer, and there were other people who were just hearing about this too. And while we were on the computer and looking at the news, we saw where the second plane crashed into the other tower. And in that moment, I said, oh, my God, you know, we're under attack. And then, of course, everybody knows what happened after that. Now, you know, it was very traumatizing. I was traumatized for a year. And, in fact, one of my cousins had died because he was a firefighter and all the chemicals and stuff, you know, all the animals that were there were dead. And this is where I saw so clearly, you know, that, you know, they were, I remember when the EPA came on, oh, it's safe, don't worry. No, and the people were saying, oh, we should leave because of the toxicity in the air. The EPA, I remember this as clear as day. No, don't go, it's safe. You could breathe the air, it's fine. We tested it, it's okay. Not. All those people who were first responders are either still very deathly sick or dead. All the animals are dead, okay? It was as toxic could be. But the human was dispensable because we had to make sure Wall Street existed. And so that was just a bold-faced lie. Looking at the towers go down, Chrissy, you know, again, we have other senses beyond the physical senses. And although I looked at it over and over again, I was speaking with my girlfriend, you know, from Brooklyn, New York. You know, we grew up together. We know each other from kindergarten. We're both, you know, traumatized. We're just on the phone and staring at this and comforting each other. There was just something, some part of me, we're just saying something's not right. I saw these towers go up. I know how they were built. And I'm saying to myself, how can they go down so fast? You know? But consciously, I couldn't, you know. So it wasn't until a year later, I actually went to New York, and I was met with a good friend of mine who was part of the spiritual discipline I was part of, Spiritual Science Center of New York, Mark. And he and a group of us went to Ground Zero, and we had to do our spiritual, you know, service to come to closure and to bless it. So, and that took a whole year in order to do that. But then after I did that, I guess I am, one of the things I'm very, very aware of is what people would call evil. You know, it's an energy. And I said there's, you know, having gone through the, you know, the book of life that was given in that dream state, you know, on some level I became aware that not everything is the way it seems, and not all that glitters is not gold, and we always have to remember that. And at some point I was contacted by somebody in service of dealing with a situation where this lady was going through a challenge, you know, dealing with a darkness, and you know, what can you do? And mostly is to be empowered in light. You know, you always have to keep your spiritual armor, you know, strong. And it was at that time she was saying that, you know, a lot of the intelligentsia in New York was saying something is not right with 9/11. I went, oh my God, I feel that too. Well, then that was the whole opening up of, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, you know, awareness of what was really going on. Now, what I did at the time And again, is, you know, what can I do to make a difference? And some people feel so overwhelmed. What can I do to make a difference? I say, do what you can, where you can, how you can. And it so turned out very synchronistically that this guy, his name was Rodriguez. Is it Carlos Rodriguez? He was the last guy that was pulled out alive, and he was the maintenance man for the World Trade Center. And some other people came to the Tampa area very synchronistically, and I went there, and they exposed the whole nine yards and could see clearly what was going on and the cover-up and blah, blah, blah. I now tell people I'm the biggest conspiracy theorist out there. So anyway, it was clear to me, you know, that there were things that were done at the expense of, you know, humanity, and that it is a manipulation, again, to a certain agenda. Some people call it the New World Order, and they have a plan, and it's the plan by they, okay, is a very small minority of people that tend to be in power and have lots of money. And that's how that paradigm has been for a very long time, for millennia. They've always had what was called the rights of king or the divine rights of king. That stuff is alive and well. People don't have a clue about it. It is. So where we are now is that the time for the illusion, you know, the time for a change in paradigm, there's a purpose for the wars. There's a purpose for the illusion of keep you separated. There's a purpose of wanting to have chaos. There's a purpose of having people's emotional bodies rattled. There's a purpose. It's serving something else. It's serving another dynamic. And ideally, they keep that, you know, from us, that we don't know that it's there and that it's happening. It's the behind the scenes. It's the shadow government. It's called many different things. But now, in the light and truth of day, as the Mayan calendars talk about the epic time, not just the Mayan calendar, from so many different cultures and ancient cultures from around the world saying this is very significant, because it's now time for a change. It's time for us as a consciousness, as a planet, to move out of the limitation of this illusion and move into our galactic place of consciousness, you know, to move into the higher frequencies, okay, where energy follows thought, and so you can manifest what you need and what you want. You know, you can realize that there's enough for everybody. You can honor all life forms that are the expressions of God or the Godhead, you know, of all things. So we're coming into that time, and how we do it is our choice. We can be in our integrity, be in our authenticity, you know, and do what we can, where we can, and how we can. Or we can choose not to. And depending on what our choices are, is how our little ride on this, you know, evolutionary roller coaster is going to be the experience. But once I would tell everybody is that, you know what, when you really know the truth, then there is no fear. First of all, if you know that there is no death, you know, let's just say, you know, what is there to be fearful of? But let's not even go there. Let's just talk about that you have the power. If you truly know how powerful you are, you have the power to create and put things in a certain direction. This is something I want to share with everybody. This is the most important thing I want to say. There is nothing and no one that has more power over you. This is how the game works. The illusion is that you're powerless. The illusion is that a perceived greater being can come and have control over you. I don't care if someone shows up on a cloud. Okay, I don't care if they can levitate. If you say, no, I don't want this, if you say, out of here, it's not happening, okay, there are universal laws that they must obey. Where the manipulation comes in is when you fall into fear. When you lose your power, when you hand it over, then that's it. So I've always, and I've had experiences in different levels and on the astral plane, and, you know, the light can also attract dark. They're not happy about giving up control and all of that kind of stuff, you know. And, of course, you always have to discern and just say, no, we're about now, you know, love and understanding and light for everybody. You know, that's just the way it is. And when I run into those situations, I tell people, pull upon whatever it is that you need to pull upon for your strength and empowerment. I pull upon my New York, you know, savvy, like, oh, no, you didn't, you know, and use that kind of strength to empower myself. So anyway, that's, you know, that's a lot of what's been going on. It's exciting times, and we all chose to be here at this time.
Absolutely. That was awesome. And we have about 8 minutes left, so I just... I guess I could take time to take a breath and try to like realize everything that you just said, the amazing information that you've just shared with us, with myself, and everybody who will be listening to this in archives, because we're off the air right now. How the truth is that we do own the power, and how many of us don't understand that, and how true it is that so many around the world don't understand the illusion of this 3D reality, and that all we have to do is own our own reality, that the secret isn't just the simple intention of it, but that there's action involved in that intention, and our dharma, understanding our work, what is our work that we must do. And I think it's to give equally what we expect to receive. We need to give equally of that to others. So I don't know what to say, except for I'm so honored, Sharon Elizabeth, Reverend Sharon Elizabeth, that you have graciously given us this information so freely, that you have worked so hard to achieve these this higher understanding of our 3D reality and what is going to bring us out of it, what is going to help us to own our power and keep us sane through these times that are coming. And I want to leave the rest of the time to you.
I would say that one of the things is, you know, be in your authenticity. Follow those little promptings, those little soul promptings. They come in very subtle ways. You know, don't doubt yourself where that is concerned. Really don't. Because as you start to follow it, you become like, wow, you know, this is real empowered. You know, this is something that's real. You know, speak your truth and walk your truth. It doesn't matter what other people think. You know, I have to be out there in the regular world too. And I am discerning. I don't necessarily blob out everything. It depends on the circumstances I am. Sometimes we're just supposed to plant seeds, and sometimes we're to be silent, and other times we're to share everything that we have. You'll be guided. You'll definitely know what to do. One of the things I wanted to share with your audience is that there's something very special. I'm going to be in the area of where I live in Sarasota for 11-11-11. You know, wherever you are, there are certain portals, and we didn't get into that. There's certain portals or intersecting lines or consciousness that open up more readily the interdimensionality reality of what we're a part. And these trigger dates, there are certain trigger dates that are pointers for this to happen. So 11-11-11 is an important day. October 28th is supposed to be the end of the Mayan calendar. This period of time is all very important. But what I want to say too is, on July of 2012, very clearly, I was told that there would be a crop circle, and that's a whole other subject, in England that will be for a particular group, that will be for all groups, but most specifically, there would be a crop circle that's very important, and the purpose of that trip is to go there. So I will be sending that information out, Chrissy, on an email, which you will receive. It's for those who feel drawn for this. It's, and of course, how it works. Who do I know in England? How is this going to happen? You know? Don't worry, we got it handled. The right person, and I, you know, I spoke to this lady and told her that, you know, this is the information I received. I received them from the Actarians. This is what they said. And she was like, oh, yes, 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 of course. Isn't it wonderful to speak to other people that know what you're talking about? So, you know, as, you know, some people say, oh, my gosh, this is really woo-woo. Well, you know, what kind of word is that? There are people who people have said were crazy when, in fact, they were just always ahead of everybody else. And one of the things, many of us that are on this call, well, certainly for myself, I've always been about 20 years ahead of the curve. So now I've become comfortable with it, you know. The fact that I don't fit in means that's a privilege. That's thank you. Thank you very much. I'm not fitting into the illusion, you know, or at least the illusion as I perceive it to be. So that's good. A lot of instructions on different things, but, you know, it's exciting and it's all good. It's all good.
It sounds wonderful. And I just want to tell you how much I love that you came and did this with me. I'm so grateful. And I'm hoping that maybe as time progresses that you'll have lots more to share with us and you will come back and do that share more
with
us.
Oh, there is so much more. There is so much more, particularly with the instructions I just got. Oh, there's so much more. And I just want to mention to you, Chrissy, that I absolutely honor and respect, you know, what you do. You know, we're all, like, we all have our puzzle pieces and we're part of this great collective. And, you know, that all of us work hard, and most certainly you do, and to take the time to do this. It's a dedication. It's being in your dharma. You know, it plays a crucial role. So I want to thank you and honor you for the great work that you do.
Well, thank you so much. I am honored to be able to do this, to have the opportunity to do this and to speak to such wonderful and great workers of light in this time that we live in. It's amazing. We live in very amazing times, and
yes, I always say
that when I can't think of anything else to say, I was like, this is just an amazing time. I always thought maybe I was born a little late because I missed it. I thought maybe I missed all the great opportunity and had no idea that
you're in the thick of it.
I was in the thick of it, so I'm like just becoming aware of that myself and listening to everything that you said. It brought so many realizations to myself about all the synchronicities with your life and how they touch on things that happen in my life. So, it's amazing. They say we run in soul groups, and I like to think that we are in the same soul group. And I know we're all in the same soul group. We're all human, and we're all,
absolutely,
you know, off the earth. But
I would
amazing.
Think that, you know, there's different levels, and, you know, I'm so grateful to be in an environment of people that know what you're talking about. They say, oh, yes, 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 I know, you know, and we're in a minority. We're in the minority, but it's growing. There's a great awakening that's taking place, you know, and, you know, we, you know, my thing is this, you know, I'm not coming back, okay? Let me do what I need to do. I'm not coming back. This is the last go round in this wheel of karma, you know? I just want to, like, and one thing I want to just say real quick that I was shown, you know, we come into such this world of illusion. It is like you can't even see your hand in front of the other. The veil is so thick, and, you know, now the veils are being removed that, you know, the souls can get here and get lost. They
absolutely,
like, completely forget. They get lost. And I'm like, oh, my God. And we all want to go back home. We all want to go back home. Where's the way home? We got to find that yellow brick home, little brick road back home. That's what we're all trying to do.
That's an interesting metaphor for the light, the way shower light way back home, yep.
Yes,
well,
yes,
thank you,
yes.
Sharon Elizabeth. We have 1 minute left, and you want to give us any inkling of...
Yes,
my
website is in construction, but if anybody wants some information, they could go to www.anchoringlightcircle.com. That's anchoringlightcircle.com. Okay, and there will be a lot of information on there. My webmaster is, you know, working as we talk right now. And I'll share a lot of information, and the trip to England is quite profound because that's for those who resonate to that, it is a specific crop circle for specific codes for activation. So, you know, if you're into the whole interdimensional trip and you feel that that is something that you're to do, then please contact me, and I'll give more information. As I said, I'll be sending that to you, Chrissy, with the newsletter. And I do have a newsletter that I send out. So if you would like to be part of the newsletter, you can email me at www.vulcana, that's V as in victory, U-L-C-A-N-A, 888 at AOL.com. Just think of the planet Vulcan with an A at the end of it. Vulcana 888 at AOL.com.
Thank you. Okay.